हेलो हेलो
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड
गुड
मॉर्निंग
मॉर्निंग
मैडम।
मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग
हाँ ओके।
मैम।
गुड
गुड मॉर्निंग गुड
मॉर्निंग
मॉर्निंग
मैम।
मैम। वॉइस इज क्लियर नो?
यस मैम।
यस मैम। एम आई ऑडिबल? ओके ओके। थैंक यू सर। हेलो हेलो।
हेलो। गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग।
हेलो। गुड मॉर्निंग मैडम अंजलि गोपालन।
गुड मॉर्निंग।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग। थैंक यू फॉर जॉइनिंग अस।
सो वी आर स्टार्टिंग एट 11, राइट?
मैडम आई विल जस्ट एक्चुअली वी वुड बिगिन एंड वी वुड बिगिन योर टॉक बाय 11 o'clock शार्प।
ओके वंडरफुल।
सो वी वुड गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी। एंड सिंस वी ऑलरेडी हैव आर रिसोर्स पर्सन आर डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट विद अस एंड ऑल आर पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू आई थिंक वी शैल बिगिन दिस प्रोग्राम नाउ। एंड सो अ वेरी वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल आर डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स। ऑल्दो लाइफ एंड एग्जिस्टेंस ऑफ ऑल ह्यूमंस नीड टू बी सेलिब्रेटेड एवरी डे, there is a need to celebrate women, recognize their contributions, and give them the due place they deserve in this social ecosystem. Hence, the United Nations has declared one day, that is the 8th of March every year, as the International Women's Day. This day is chosen to mark women's contribution to cultural, social, political, and economic development in society. It is also to encourage women to empower themselves, assert their rights, and strive for an equal place in this world. We are in the 21st year of the 21st century, and women are still struggling to be recognized as equals. According to a report from the United Nations International Labour Organization, women worldwide make 77% of the amount paid to men. According to the United Nations, worldwide, just 24% of all national parliamentarians were females, as recorded and reported in February 2019. Women are a minority in the technical industry as well as media. Female entrepreneurs receive less funding and investments. Despite being as successful as their male counterparts, women in sports still face gender inequality. Women are far more likely to be victims of human trafficking, molestation, and domestic violence. Women of all races are, in fact, more likely than men to live below the poverty line. Till today, women do the lion's share of the household chores. Well, my purpose was not to foreground gender inequality, but to draw the attention to the fact that we have a long journey ahead and the path may seem rocky to this journey of journey that would lead to the destination of equality. But we have to move forward. We need to renew our energies and vigor. We need to take charge and continue sculpting our own destinies. Even if we have to work twice as hard or more than men to prove ourselves, we must and we will move on. On the eve of International Women's Day, it is time to rekindle our passions, our aspirations, our beliefs in ourselves. It is time to dare and defy ourselves and those who doubt and undermine us to forge ahead. It is time to reach for the stars. With this purpose, Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education warmly welcomes all of you to this national webinar, Reach for the Stars. I now request our principal, Dr. Anita Swami, to please welcome our distinguished guest, Madam Anjali Gopalan, and the participants. Over to you, Madam, Dr. Anita Swami.
Thank you, Anjit, and greeting to all. A warm welcome to the national seminar, Reach to the Stars, organized by the Women Developmental Cell of Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education under the aegis of research. 8 March is observed the world over as International Women's Day to organize and celebrate women and their immense contribution to society. Fortunately, today we are in a world where girls are in the classroom of the schools and colleges in large numbers. But in the journey of life, many of them abandon and compromise their ambitions and dreams under pressure, which may be social or self-imposed. Many a leader, an entrepreneur, or a change maker that is lying dormant in these women needs to be aroused from hibernation and released. These women need to be inspired to keep dreams big and muster all the strength and courage to make their dreams a reality. So, on the eve of International Women's Day, we decide to ignite and manifest that spark of ambition and dreams that lies in our student teachers and fraternity of all teachers who are women as well as men, so that they go beyond their limitations and achieve their possibilities, so that they reach out to the sky and pluck out some stars. To do this, we are so glad that we have 3 dazzling stars with us today. Ms. Anjali Gopalan, human rights activist, founder and executive director of NAS Foundation. Captain Jaswinder Kaur Kapoor, airlines pilot, Airbus A320. And Dr. Namita Chaudhary, laparoscopist and endoscopist with us. I extend a very warm welcome to these wonderful women of substance who will make our webinar dazzle with the brilliance of their work and their inspiring stories. A very warm welcome to our students and participants from all over Mumbai and the country. Wishing you all a very inspiring Women's Day, and may you reach for the stars and beyond. Thanks for joining us. Over to you, Mandy.
Thank you, Madam. Thank you so much. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, it is a privilege to introduce our first guest speaker, Ms. Anjali Gopalan, to all of you. Ms. Anjali Gopalan is the founder and executive director of the Das Foundation India Trust, a Delhi-based NGO dedicated to fighting HIV/AIDS. Ms. Anjali began working on the issue related to HIV/AIDS and the marginalized communities in the United States. And upon returning to India in the early 1990s and noticing the apathy of government and civil society, she founded the NAS India in 1994 with the mission to focus on and support the stigmatized and vulnerable communities affected by the HIV. In 2000, the HIV/AIDS crisis resulted in infected and abandoned orphans. Madam Anjali opened the NAS Care Home to provide a safe and supportive environment for children living with HIV. Today, the NAS Care Home has given a lifetime commitment to provide a home for 29 children between the ages of 5 and 17 years. As a strong advocate for the sexual health and rights of the LGBT community, Madam Anjali spearheaded the 8-year legal battle against Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code. In 2001, her organization filed a public interest litigation to decriminalize homosexuality and put an end to the law under which individuals were harassed and discriminated against based on their sexual orientation. The Delhi High Court ruled in favor of NAS India in 2000 and declared Section 377 an infringement on individual rights. Madam Gopalan's activism has reached out to the environment as well as animals, and she sincerely believes that animals have a right to a non-speciesist, cruelty-free life. They need to be recognized as sentient beings, no different from humans, and must be included in the global social justice movement along with all the other liberation movements. Driven by this passion and love for animals, Madam Anjali established an animal sanctuary, all creatures great and small, at Silakhari, Haryana. And the mission of this foundation is to create a compassionate sanctuary for the old, sick, abandoned animals, to create a home for them till the end of their lives, either at the sanctuary or through their adoption programs. Madam Anjali also serves as a board member of the Animal Welfare Board of India and ensures that the laws and civilian practices go hand in hand with the existing animal laws of the country and seek redressal for the grievances done against animals. For all this noble work, Madam has received numerous accolades and several awards. I would just be highlighting a few. In 2005, Madam was nominated and shortlisted for the Nobel Peace Prize in recognition of her work to bring harmony to those whose lives have none. In 2007, Madam was honored as a woman achiever by the Ministry of Women and Child Development, along with 9 other awardees. And in the same year, she became an Ashoka Fellow in recognition of her achievements as a social entrepreneur. In recognition of her work in campaigning against homophobia, Madam Anjali was named one of Forbes India's top influential people of 2009. In 2013, Madam Gopalan was awarded the Chevalier de la Légion d'honneur by Ms. Najat Balod Belkacem, the Honorable Minister for Women's Rights and the spokesperson of the French government. And in 2019, the former Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh, awarded Madam with the Change Maker of the Year Award for her legal battle in decriminalizing homosexuality. We are so honored to have with us such an accomplished individual. Life is a mission, and who wants to take up all noble causes and fight for them? Madam Anjali Gopalan, we extend a very, very warm welcome on behalf of Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education, our principal, Dr. Anita Swami, all of us at the college and our participants. And now the virtual days is all yours. Madam, we wish to have you.
Thanks a lot. Can you hear me?
Yes, madam.
I'm never sure about this communications piece. Okay. So, good morning, everyone, and thank you for those wonderful words. I am truly honored to be here because I think it means a lot. It means the very fact that you've invited me to be here is a great acknowledgement of my work. So thank you very much. So I was asked to speak a little bit about my journey, which is how I'll start. And then I will open it out to questions, and you can ask me anything. There are no wrong questions. So let's use this time and space to try and figure out our way forward, because as women, in this country, we have a long way to go, even though we have come a long way. I started my work with HIV in the US. This was when HIV had kind of just started. So we didn't know much about it. And this was in the mid 80s when I started working with HIV. And when I came back, then I decided to come back to India for various reasons, which is what happened in 94. And I decided to continue with my work because I think that's what HIV does to you. Once you start working with HIV, it kind of grasps you and doesn't let you go. Because I think HIV actually makes you aware of many things, including your culture, including your attitude, including your understanding of what is right and what is wrong. I think it slaps you in the face every day and makes you look at these issues. So it tends to have a great grip on your thinking and the evolution of your thinking. So when I came back to India, this was towards the end of 94, I was trying to figure out how does one even start looking at what to do with HIV. The government had already started a program, which was, thank God they had. But I felt, for example, I had come from that space where I had seen it was very much, the infection was very visible in the gay community in the US. I had seen a lot of people die. Funerals were the order of the day. So I felt that gay friends of mine here said, listen, why aren't you working with the community? And I said, okay, fine, it makes sense. Maybe that's the way to go. So I started my work with the community and very quickly realized two things. One, that many men having sex with men didn't necessarily identify as being gay, and they were married to women. So therefore, what really struck me was the impact on the lives of women and children. So I felt that if we didn't do something very quickly, we were going to see a tremendous rise in the number of infections in women and children. I definitely saw the infection as going from men to men to women. So even though I started work with the gay community, very quickly I decided one needed to start working with women. And interestingly, at that time, when I did go to women's groups, they said it wasn't an issue for women, right? So one had to really start convincing them that, look, you have to understand that it is going to be a huge issue for women. And my whole argument was, because HIV is a sexually transmitted infection, that we needed to talk to women about, with women about sexuality and protection, just as we needed to talk to men about the same, because this was something that was not happening. So very quickly, along with that, one of the things I think HIV makes you realize, at least this is my understanding, that if you don't value yourself, you're not going to protect yourself. And the one thing one noticed about the gay community, at least men having sex with men, there were no role models. I would have young men telling me, is there any medicine that will make me feel different? Which used to break my heart. Because can you imagine? And it's such an intrinsic part of who you are. And you want to change that. The pressure to get married, both on men and women. Because if you think about it, when I would ask, why do you want to get married? You're not attracted to women. Why would you do this to women, right? And the answer would be, the family wants me to get married. Family name has to continue. Who will look after me in my old age? You know, reasons people give for getting married. Who will look after my parents? So I felt it was critical that we start looking at developing community, creating community spaces so that this pressure on men to get married eases a bit. That was one. Then the other bit was, how does one work with women? Because again, sexuality is something that we don't talk about with women at all. As a matter of fact, I don't think we give the women give women the wherewithal to be able to discuss any of these issues. Even today, many young women I talk to say that they cannot imagine talking to their husbands or their partners about sexuality or about sex, because they feel that they'll be judged and they will get into trouble. So I felt it was really important to start looking at HIV more broadly, rather than just being limited to the to homosexual men. So we started work with young people. We had a huge peer education program where we worked with schools and colleges. We started working with women because one of the things that has happened with the HIV prevention program in our country, that the focus has been on what are called high-risk groups, something I don't agree with, because I don't think there are high-risk groups. I think there is high-risk behavior. But the focus was on, for example, men having sex with men, or sex workers, female sex workers, or truck drivers at one time. And the general population was left out of the discourse. So, for example, we found that a lot of young married women were coming to us who were positive. But the messaging that was going out in society is that if you are at risk of HIV infection if you have multiple sexual partners. And then these women were telling us, look, this is my first partner. So we found a lot of young women getting infected, because how does one know? How does one protect oneself? How does one even bring up these issues? And in all my work across the country, one of the questions I've always asked women, older women, that would you get your future son-in-law tested for HIV? Would you ask any of those questions? And the answer, 9.5 out of 10 times, was, how can we do that? Then who will marry our daughter? So it became critical, I felt, that we really needed to broaden our understanding of how to start talking about these issues with women. Because, of course, sex workers are a captive population in many ways, especially the brothel-based ones. However, how do you go to the average housewife and tell her to protect yourself? It is a problem. How do you do that? So this, and therefore, even the government really has done nothing about reaching out to general population of women. And I understand why that's happened, because it is not easy to do it. But I think we really, even now, now when I look at what's happening in the present time, there's hardly any information out there for people to access. There is no public information, there is no messaging, all of that, because it seems like we're behaving like HIV doesn't exist anymore. Yet I must share with you that I'm still seeing young women who are coming in infected. I'm still seeing young gay men who are getting infected. So I think for us not to focus anymore on HIV is going to take us back many steps. And over the years, one of the things that has happened with me is that out of a strange sense of frustration of seeing young women increasingly getting infected, I then said, okay, let's try and see if we can look at it a bit differently. So then we started looking at, could we look at a program which empowers women in some ways to be able to make decisions to protect themselves. So one of my ex-board members actually of the organization suggested sport as a medium. And my response to him at that time was, oh my God, I know nothing about this. So he said, why don't you give it a shot? What can happen? So I said, well, we can fail. So he says, so what? So I said, that's true, so what? So we started looking at working with young girls in between the age group of 12 to 18. And the sport we chose was netball because it's a non-contact sport. And we thought we would work in schools as well as communities which are marginalized. And excuse me, this is one of my dogs barking. So it was interesting. I somehow was a bit nervous about whether it'll work or not. But interestingly, it's become one of our biggest programs where we're looking at leadership development through sport. And I must share with you, it is amazing when I see when one of these young women enters the program, and by the time she leaves the program, everything, whether it is the way she walks, the way she dresses, the way she carries herself, everything seems to change because of sports. So now I'm a great advocate of the need for women to be involved in sports. Very critical. Very critical. I think it really does wonderful things for us. It makes us so much more confident in our bodies and in ourselves. And along with the sport, we also do sessions on various issues. So, and then post that, we have a program where we do soft skill development. So many of them get jobs. And interestingly, and this is anecdotal, it's not a research piece, but what we've seen in our work is that parents of these young women are not forcing them to get married as soon as they finish school. So they're 16, 17, and now that they're getting these jobs, that pressure is not as much as it used to be earlier. But again, this is an NGO intervention, right? So we cannot have the reach. So unless governments get involved, because if we need reach, if we need to reach large numbers, we're looking at that kind of involvement. We can reach, say, 20,000 girls, 30,000 girls. But look at the number there are in this country who need these inputs. And they do make a difference. That we have proven and shown. So one of the things I really want to see happen is that governments get involved. Colleges like yours get involved, schools get involved, because I think that's the only way to go. That's the only way we're going to, I hate the word empower, because somehow I feel government has appropriated it, but empower women, right? How does one develop those skills to feel that you're in a situation where you can protect yourself, bring change, be a person who is an agent of change. So I think HIV makes you look at all these issues. Because whether you like it or not, all of us, you, me, all of us are at risk of getting infected. So that is something we have to always keep in mind. So how do we protect ourselves? by talking about sexuality, by talking about protection. But the issue is that most of us are really nervous talking about sex because we're going to be judged. The moment we know something, we are seen as bad women. So it's how do we make that shift in our heads of how do we stop judging ourselves? How do we ensure society stops judging us? So I think these are skills that as young people, you all need to develop. And a lot of it just has to do with information and strength from within. But it's not an impossibility, right? Because when I see so many young people today, there is a change. I'm not saying there's no change. If I think about when I started 25 years ago and today, there's a huge change. However, I still think we have a long journey ahead of us because laws are not in place. People are still, equality is not something we are close to. And when I say equality, it's not about just men and women. When I talk about gender, it's not only about women. It's across the board for everyone, whatever or whoever one identifies with, right? So I think we have a long way to go, but I also think we must be very proud of what we have achieved so far as a society, as a culture. The other major shift that has happened for me is my understanding of rights has evolved. I no longer can see rights as being us versus them. Rights has to be part of a continuum. If we don't look at that, if we don't look at the world as a one world, whether it is the coming together of environment, animals, human beings, I think pandemics like what we're going through right now are going to become the order of the day. Therefore, it becomes important. It becomes very important for us to understand that there is a connect between all of this. And if we don't think about the environment, I don't think we're going to leave this world in a better place for the next generation. And all of us can contribute towards making this universe a better place, whether it is stopping the use of plastic, whether it is looking at alternatives. For example, I make my own cleaning agents from the peels of oranges, right? I have plates and glasses lying in my car. So even when I go to eat Golgappas, I take my own plate, so I'm not generating more more garbage. So I think it's how do we make these small changes to bring about some change in this world, yeah? So I'm going to stop now and open it up for questions. I'm happy to take questions, Manjeet.
Yeah. Yes, madam. Our participants have already posted the questions. And for this, I request Dr. Archana Kadgari to please address those questions by the participants for Mani.
Very good morning. Thank you, Manjeet ma'am. Yeah, Anjali ma'am, as very rightly said by you, the change in the attitude is very important. And the questions are also pertaining to the same.
One second, there's a call in between. So, Sabal.
Okay, ma'am.
The problem with the phone is that suddenly someone calls and then your voice goes off. So, I'm just going to get the
your phone.
Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, I'll
just give me a second.
So, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, let's just continue. Huh?
Okay, ma'am. The first question, ma'am, as you addressed about equality, there is one question pertaining to that. If everyone was equal, would society still function in a normal way, or will there be a lack of will to achieve excellence?
Okay. What is normal, number one? I mean, to me, the word normal is so laden, right? And why do we think that if we are equal as society, we'll stop functioning? Is it that, my question then is, does this dissonance have to be there all the time? Because when we're looking at equality, what are we looking at? We're looking at a just and equitable society where everyone has equal access. So for example, a country in a culture like ours, which is so stratified on class and caste lines, how do we then bring about change? So are we saying that if all of us were equal, everything would stop functioning, or that we would not be able to progress as a society? I personally don't think so. First of all, I don't think it's going to be so easy to bring about this kind of equality. It's a long journey. In spite of fairly strong laws, we still haven't been able to accomplish that, if you think about it, right? In spite of trying to fight for equality, we still have laws which are which do not allow equal access to everyone. For example, women in many cases, it's a case in point. The LGBTQI community is a case in point. We still deny them all the basic rights that society takes for granted. So given that, I don't think we need to worry right now about whether it will create that kind of dissonance. I don't think it will. No. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Yeah. Ma'am, as you rightly said, the role of the school and the colleges in all these things is very important. So the next questions are pertaining to that. How do I help as a teacher for the cause of girls' education and weaker section of the society?
As a teacher?
Yes, ma'am, as a teacher.
By actually, my immediate first response that came into my head was by making yourself as open and accessible as possible. Stop seeing yourself only as a teacher. Stop seeing yourself as someone who is in a position of authority, because I think very often students find it difficult to reach out to teachers because they feel very judged by teachers. So I think the first thing as a teacher, what we need, as anybody who's a teacher, I think we need to work on ourselves. How do we make ourselves more open so that people don't feel that they will be judged or they will not be valued or they will be seen as bad people if they reach out to that teacher. So this whole judgmental attitude, which is, by the way, we all are a part of our environment and our society. None of us is born non-judgmental. None of us is born knowing better. So it is, how open are you to learn from your experiences and the experiences of others? Because respect is something that is a very taught and learned behavior. And again, I go back to us being so stratified on caste lines. As a culture, we learn to discriminate right from the time we're in the womb. It's there. It's part of who we are. So therefore, how do we unlearn that? So as a teacher, that is something you have to really work on, I feel.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, rightly so. Ma'am, the next question is, how to change the mentality of people in our society towards women?
Okay, that's a big one. I think, first of all, not easy. right? But what does help are strong laws. To some extent, at least if you have the law, you can fall back on it, right? And what gives me hope is if you think of something like sati, you remember in Northern India, especially, sati was the norm. No widowed woman could imagine not performing sati in a state like Rajasthan, for example, right? It was so accepted. Yet the law changes and attitudes change. And today I don't see any woman trying to immolate herself on the funeral pyre. So I think laws help. But what would really help is how do we change our own mentality? How do we as women bring up children who actually learn to respect each other? How do we bring up sons who are raised as responsible young men? I think a lot has to do with the way we ourselves look at attitude towards the male child. I continue to get horrified that in this day and age, in a city like Delhi, we've come across so many instances where sons are still preferred over daughters, right? And that's the norm in our society. I'm not saying Delhi is different, but the fact that you are sitting in the capital of the country and look at the number of female births compared to men, to boys. So I think a lot has to do with us changing our own way of looking at issues and looking at life and looking at how we value sons. Again, it's a very cultural thing, but it's something that we have to work on, right? So it's us. I always say that you have to put yourself in the center of the intervention. If you bring about change, that is when change will happen. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. And that is a very learned behavior. Again, you have to be open. You have to allow for different forces to understand the different ways of thinking. It has so much to do with us, ourselves.
Yes, ma'am, as you said, that individual effort is very important and not looking for somebody else to do it. Rather, we should take the initiative first. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question is, how to create awareness and sensitization about LGBTQ community in schools?
Yeah. Okay. Listen. When we are looking at the creating awareness and sensitization for the LGBT community, we have to look at it in a larger context. Unfortunately, in our school system, even today in our school system, sex education is not part of the curriculum, right? People who are in positions of decision making still think that if we have sex education in schools, our young people are going to become promiscuous. So we are still battling at that level, trying to convince them that there is age appropriate information that needs to be shared with our young people. And as a matter of fact, UNICEF did a study, this was a few years ago, I forget the year that it was done. But they found very high rates of sexual abuse of children in India, which means, to me, that's an indication that from the time the child is fairly young, they need to get information on something as basic as what is a right touch and what is a wrong touch, and who do you go to when someone does something to you? How do you work with parents to believe children when they come to them that someone is abusing them? Right? So all of this hasn't even happened. And what happens with children who are from the community, especially trans children and effeminate gay children or very masculine girls is that there is a lot of abuse in the school system, both physical, sexual, and mental. And we find a lot of children who are visibly part of this community drop out of school. The reason they drop out of school is because of their visibility. There are many who are able to hide it and therefore are able to get through the system. So unless we are open to these issues and unless authorities, so very often someone like me would go and convince schools to allow us to do sessions on various issues, including the LGBTQI issues. And obviously, for example, if you're going to go into government schools, they're not going to allow it, period. Private schools, yes, very often they would. But my point is this has to become systemic. It cannot be ad hoc in this manner, because if you, again, looking at reach, again, looking at changing attitudes, it can't be this ad hoc manner where some NGO is going to some school and convincing them and that's it. Government needs to step in. We need to these issues to become part of our education system. We have to talk about sex education and not as life skills. We have to respect our young people and understand that they're not fools. And young people do realize if you give them the right options, if you give them the understanding, they'll make the right decisions. So I think we have to learn to respect. That is the bottom line. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Over to you, Manjeet, ma'am.
Yeah.
Manjeet, ma'am, you are kindly unmute yourself, Manjeet, ma'am.
Yes. We have some questions on the Zoom chat too, madam. And I request Dr. Usha Borkar to address those questions for madam. Dr.
Usha Borkar. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Manji. Ma'am, there are several questions on the Zoom chat. So I'll pose the first question, which is put by our principal, ma'am, Dr. Anita Swami. Will it be apt to address issue of HIV with respect to LGBTQ community and not just gay community?
Yes, absolutely. I think HIV has to be addressed across the board. It has nothing to do only with the gay community, all the LGBTQI community. And as I said, it also has to do, look, we need to get this information out to women. We need to get this information out to young men, all men. We need, this is an issue that impacts lives across the board. So if you have an immune system, you are at risk. So I'm assuming all of us have an immune system. So all of us are at risk, and therefore all of us need the correct information. Information that is non-judgmental and information that will allow us to protect ourselves, which means we have to talk really openly about sex, about sexuality, about drug use, about partners. All of this, we need to talk openly about these issues, which is a tall order, right? It's not very comfortable. As a matter of fact, every time I do sessions, school teachers will tell me, "Hey, madam, it's okay, you've come and done it and it's great, the kids loved it. But you know, we have to see these kids every day. How can we look at them if they're going to talk to us about masturbation and sex and this and that?" But my point is that therefore, teachers also need to be trained. Doctors need to be trained. Everyone, anyone who's getting an education in any profession needs to be trained on these issues around attitudes. Not just HIV, it's about attitudes. So and how does one get comfortable about it? The only reason one can talk about these issues is if you yourself are very comfortable with these issues. That's the first step. So it's always about you. It's never about someone out there. right? And if you're comfortable and can talk about it and be open to it, you'll find that people will open out to you. They will ask you their doubts and fears. That I can guarantee. There's very little I can guarantee, but this is the one thing I can guarantee, is that if you yourself are open and have learned to become non-judgmental, people will access you for information. No doubt in my mind about it.
Thank you, ma'am. There's another question, and it is in reference to what you had said earlier, that sports was an intervention among women to build confidence and self-worth. So Ms. Thapa is curious to know whether this intervention was limited to specific people group or just random groups of women in the, random groups of women, is what she said, in the community.
So we worked at, we're working with government schools, some private schools, and then we're working in communities. So it's been across the board. But the thing is that, again, I come back to the fact that this intervention is has to be limited by the very virtue of the fact that it's being done by an NGO. You know, we can show you what works, what doesn't work. That we can do. We can share our experiences. But it's a drop in the ocean. Look at the numbers we need to reach to actually bring about change everywhere. It can't happen by one or two or three or four NGOs, right? It has to happen. It has to be a concerted effort by different groups. And I go back to government. Government has to buy into this. Unfortunately, that is the weak link in all of this. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. There's another question from Ms. Shreya Parikh, and she says that, do you agree that more than changing the mindset of the youngsters, it would first be practiced and accepted by parents? When children see their parents implement, the children automatically start inculcating these habits. There can be more focus on taking programs for parents and make their mindset stronger so they can make their kids stronger as well. Ma'am, what's your opinion on this?
I agree totally. And there's no way to work with children if parents are not part of that process. So even in our sport for leadership development that we do, we always first get the permission of the parents. We also involve them in doing little sporting activities. We also share with them what we will be teaching their kids so that they're comfortable. When I do workshops in schools on HIV and LGBTQI issues, I always address the PTAs first. And I do a little session on sexuality with the parents. Because there is a tremendous fear factor among parents. That needs to be addressed. But you're right. I think if the adults change their attitudes, of course it'll trickle down to children. Because children learn what the message that adults give them. So I agree with you totally. We cannot leave adults out of this process. So when we work with communities, we work across the board. It's not that you're working only with young people, right? You have to involve the adults who are a part of their lives.
Thank you, ma'am. There is another question from Ms. Kruti Parikh, and she says that, can we have gender and sex education as a part of the curriculum from grade 5 or 6, considering that that's the age when one starts facing several changes in their bodies? Will that help them, that means the children, to accept themselves as they are?
I think it should start earlier. Because as I said earlier, we need to know our bodies and we are aware of ourselves fairly early in life. And if the UNICEF study is anything to go by, I would say we need to start much earlier. Also remember, abuse is something that happens often within the known environment, which is your home. No one is coming from outside to abuse you very often. I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but I'm saying usually abuse happens within the environment that we are in. So therefore, these issues need to be addressed from a much earlier age, I feel. But what you're saying is in grade five and all, there is age-appropriate information which has to be shared. For example, what I would tell a fifth grader, I'm not going to share the same information with someone in the 12th standard. So there is age-appropriate information, and adults are very worried that, if you're going to talk about these issues, I don't know what will happen. My children will become. The point is, children don't become like that. Children are not fools. Young people are not idiotic, right? And when we talk about sexuality, for example, we also talk about consequences of behavior. How to deal with peer pressure, for example, right? So it's not in a vacuum. But definitely, I would say I would start much earlier than the fifth grade.
Thank you, ma'am. Those were the questions that were posed in the Zoom chat. So I shall request Dr. Manjeet to take over.
Thank you. Thank you, Usha. I think we have a few questions on the WhatsApp chat, if I'm not mistaken, Dr. Archana.
Yes, Manjeet, yeah. Ma'am. So very we can take
up to two questions at least.
Yeah, okay. Ma'am, Anjali ma'am, I think everybody would like to know about this. This question has been posed by Dr. Vaishali Sawant. As a woman, how have you prepared yourself or molded yourself to take up these community activities which are considered a taboo? What were the challenges faced by you, ma'am?
It's interesting. I think what helped me was I'm a woman. To me, that has been a big plus point. But I must say that if it hadn't been for the kind of inputs that I got from my parents, I wouldn't do what I am doing. And I must share this story with you. When I was in college, your age, I had no idea. My mother was from Punjab. My dad's from the South. But I had no idea. When I was in college, suddenly I got to know that thanks to a friend of mine asking my mother in front of me about my grandparents, all I knew that was my grandparents were dead. I had never kind of, asked the question, how, where, why, nothing. I don't know why I hadn't, but I hadn't. And then suddenly this friend of mine asked my mother, and she said, yes, her parents had been killed in front of her during partition. So then her uncle managed to get her out of Pakistan. She was from Lahore. And my reaction at that time was one of pure horror. And then I said, my God, how could you forgive them? So my mother said, them? She said, what do you mean by them? I said, yeah, weren't they Muslims who killed my grandparents? So she said, it was an individual who killed your grandparents. He happened to be Muslim. But please remember, this happened on both sides. It had nothing to do with religion. Hindus did it, Muslims did it, and I don't ever want to hear you say this again. I think that's when, for me, I started understanding what rights is and what respect is. And I was just thinking, what if it was my parents who had been killed? Would I? That was my response, right? So I must say that her thinking and the way she phrased it and the way she explained it to me actually set me on this journey of understanding rights and looking at rights and learning to respect diversity. That's what it was. Not to judge someone based on their belief. That's what it was. So I think parents have a huge role to play in our attitudes and how those attitudes are shaped. I can't ever remember my gay friends who were in relationships not being called as couples to my house by my parents whenever they called them for a meal or whatever, because all my friends always were coming in and out. But if someone was in a relationship, they were always called as a couple. So I was blessed by by parents who were extremely progressive and open-minded. And I wonder what made them that. I still haven't figured out that one. But it's interesting. I think so much has to do with the kind of messaging we give young people. And I was very lucky and blessed to get that kind of input. Yeah.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question is on professionalism. Professionalism may at times restrict us from going an extra mile to achieve excellence. How can we balance, especially in a big organization? Maybe this is pertaining to women balancing all those restrictions posed on them.
By whom?
Yeah, definitely by the organizations and yes.
Yeah, I don't think professionalism is what holds you back. You're holding yourself back. Because frankly, if you're professional, why should it hold you back? The issue is how the kind of stance we take and how much are we willing to compromise? Or do we feel the need to compromise? And I know it's hard. It's hard. If you are, for example, if you're a strong woman or you're doing well in your workspace, it's not uncommon to hear. I hear it all the time. I'll have someone say, "Arey, she though sleeps with so-and-so, that's why she's doing so well." And let me tell you, I always put a stop to that kind of talk immediately. Because it's I don't think your professionalism is stopping you. What is stopping us is us placing value on what the world is. We have to fight it. I think we must understand that it's critical for us to continue to be professional. That's not going to stop us. But for us to ensure that we keep updated, to ensure that we work with a strong value base, and you may still lose out, of course. But for me, that is what has always worked. And so I would say, please don't hold yourself back. And being professional is not what is going to create issues for you. Actually, being non-professional is what is going to create issues.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Over to you, Manjeet, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Archana. Dr. Usha Borkar, I think there are a few questions that you would like to address. Yes,
yes, yes, Dr. Manjeet. So we have one more question from our principal, ma'am, Dr. Anita Swami, ma'am. She asks, what are your views about movement like Me Too?
Me Too? Well, I'm glad there is such a movement only because it's given the opportunity for women to be able to at least voice what they have been going through. So I think it's a great thing that has happened. Is it so? The correspondent question to me always is, hasn't it gone too far? That's what I'm always asked, more than what I think about. So the thing is, I feel if we didn't have a movement like this, I think it would have been detrimental for women. It's helpful for them. And therefore, I look at the whole the Priya and Akbar case, right? Can you imagine if this Me Too movement hadn't been there, would it have even come out? And we're talking about a journalist a so-called empowered woman who just didn't have the opportunity or the space to be able to talk about these issues. So I'm a great I'm a great admirer of the movement, but I also think there has to be a responsibility on the side of women too. Sure, but this is true for anything that we do, right? As individuals, not only as women, that whatever decisions and choices we make, we must hold ourselves responsible for that. Do these things get misused? Sure, of course they do. That doesn't mean these laws or movements shouldn't exist. Because for many, many, many women, this is a space that they can access and protect themselves.
Thank you, ma'am. You have given us a lot of things to think about. There's one last question from Ms. Shreya Parekh, and she says, what can be done for a permanent change in the attitude? Because many a times these programs happen, they try to bring change, but after some time, one forgets about the seriousness of these programs. So what should be done to bring about a permanent change in the attitudes?
Listen, this is such a personal thing. One is yes. Therefore, it has to be institutionalized. Whether you these issues are dealt with through curriculums, whether, for example, teachers' curriculums should involve this as an underlying teaching technique and tools should be available to teachers, right? To doctors, to anyone who goes through professional training. And then this is something that young people have to be taught to always work on. Because how does one enforce change in attitude? You can't. However, you have to change, you have to expose people, and then you have to also protect it through laws. Without the other. And if you look at ethics and law, very often they are two sides of the same coin, but the two never work at the same pace. So yes, it's a work in progress all the time. And change in attitude is you yourself understanding and then really working on yourself after getting the inputs that you get. But without those inputs, it's virtually impossible, I think. Therefore, even the Supreme Court, for example, when they finally decriminalized homosexuality, one of the things the Supreme Court said was that we need to bring about a change in society, and that can only happen if you make it part of the learning process, the education process. Without that, it's going to be very difficult.
Thank you, ma'am. Those were the questions on the Zoom chat. So over to you, Dr. Manjeet.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, Madam Gopalan, for that. This very thought-provoking conversation, especially of topics which are taboo and people don't so easily open up and talk about. And you have also very nicely driven home this point that we all women need to first be the change that we need to see around us, and we need to work on ourselves.
Manjeet, madam, there are questions on animal rights also. So if we can take this one question.
All
on
right, sure, rights. Surely, Vaishali ma'am, please, you can pose that question for madam.
Archana, Dr. Archana, please.
Yes, Vaishali ma'am. Ma'am, the participants want to know from where can they get the correct information regarding animal rights?
Well, there's a lot of information out there on the net, number one. Number two, if someone is specifically interested, please do write to me and I can dig up information. If there's specific issues you want information on, feel free to write to me and I will send you information, because I think this is an area that if we don't work on, we are going to see newer pandemics, which we are not going to be able to deal with. To me, what is frightening is, in this whole one world discourse that is happening, we are already talking, and people are not aware about this, we are already talking about the next two pandemics that are going to be worse than corona, that are going to emerge from factory farmed chickens and swine and pigs. Because of the way that we are caging the animals and bringing them up for eating. So I think this is something that many of us are not even aware of. The WHO is already talking about it. But when I talk to people, no one seems to know about anything. Or haven't heard of this. So therefore, please feel free to write to me. And whatever information I have, I will share with you. Yeah. So maybe you can share my email, gopalan.anjali@gmail.com. So just flip my name and that's it. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Over to you, Manji, ma'am.
Yes, I'm sure, madam. Actually, our participants may have still many more questions, but for the constraints of time, we would have to leave it at this juncture. And as you have said, if you will Google madam's name, you would be able to access madam's access her foundation, the NAS Foundation, her email address, and you can send all your queries and your conversations with madam on those. So it's time for us to propose a formal vote of thanks for you, madam, this very thought-provoking conversation that we've had with you, for which I would like to invite Dr. Shreema Banerjee. Dr. Shreema Banerjee.
Yes. Thank you, Manjeet madam. First of all, I would like to thank Madam Gopalan for such an insightful experience of yours that you have shared, ma'am. It was really so nice to hear about the journey, and it somehow gave a motivation also that we also need to look in these areas and to contribute, do our contributions for the welfare of the community. Maybe the tremendous work that you are doing, we will not be able to reach that, but even a small bit of it, if we try to do, maybe perhaps we will feel that yes, today's star, Madam Gopalan, as the theme of our webinar is Reach for the Stars, ma'am. We had a wonderful star today. And especially I will take away, along with the participants, that you said, if we don't value ourselves, we can't take care of ourselves. That's very true, ma'am. We need to really value ourselves so that we can take care of ourselves. Such a wonderful, talk it was, that all of us were totally with you throughout the session, ma'am, without any PowerPoint presentation, just a talk, and you took all of us over. Thank you so much, ma'am. And it's definitely that the sports and the role of sports that you tapped upon, again, we feel that we also, as a being into the education field, we also would like to take up this as an activity and we would like to promote this. Thank you very much, ma'am. On behalf of our management, Gujarat Research Society, our principal, Dr. Anita Swami, entire HJCE family, and on behalf of all the participants, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks, ma'am, for taking out time from your busy schedule, being with us, and really answering all the questions from the participants and making us all feel that yes, you are the star for the day. Thank you very much, ma'am. Over to you, Manjeet.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Madhu. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye bye. Bye bye. So yes, after this very inspirational talk by Dr. Gopalan, it is time to take on to a flight where we have on board with us Captain Jasvinder Kaur, and she would be maneuvering this flight for us the next 45 minutes. Let's enjoy this flight. And for this, I would invite Dr. Karuna Sinha to give us a peek into Captain Jasvinder Kaur's life. Yes, over to you, Dr. Karuna Sinha.
A warm welcome
And now we have moved into afternoon, ma'am. So a warm good afternoon to all of you. I feel blessed and privileged to introduce our second speaker to all of you, Captain Jaswinder Kaur Kapoor. Captain Jaswinder Kaur Kapoor is currently an airlines pilot of Airbus A320 with a prominent airlines company of India. Captain Jaswinder Kaur has been flying since the last 15 years. She has 10,000 hours of flying experience and has taken command as captain of the flight since the past 10 years. Her qualifications that have taken her where she is are, she has acquired her training and completed her flying hours from the Haryana Institute of Civil Aviation Flying Club at Pinjor Karnal and Northern India Flying Club Patiala. She passed the theoretical exams of the Director General of Civil Aviation and got herself a commercial pilot license. She acquired the multi-engine rating of training from Melbourne. Captain Jaswinder Kaur Kapoor's journey is of a 12-year-old girl from a small town resolving to fly in the skies and making this dream a reality. Ma'am, we believe that you decided and you now fly. You broke walls and scaled heights of joy. And today you being around, let's also decide and let our spirits free and rule our dream sky also. Ma'am, thank you for being around. And on behalf of Gujarat Research Society's Hansraj Jeevandas College of Education, our principal, Dr. Anita Swamy, and entire JC family, including our participants, I extend again a very warm welcome to you. And now I request you to please begin with your session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you so very much. I think that's like the most elaborated version of my introduction I have ever heard about myself. And please don't call me ma'am. Everyone calls me Jessie. And that's what I would like to prefer to be called upon. So it's in flight, like people call me Pilot Jessie, and at moments I'm just known as Jessie. And as you all know, Jessie, koi nahi. So thank you very much, to giving me this opportunity to come and share some parts from my life and where maybe, thanks Manjeetji, especially to you, that I can share my experience and whatever little bit from my own life with all, from the fraternity and the students and the young girls, maybe they get some inspiration out of it. And then, we'll have more of Jessies, and more, not just Jessie, they make their own mark. And as you have already, elaborated about my journey, how I've, from where I belong and all. Yes, I'm a very small town girl who had a dream, and it was like, I don't know from where that dream has come in my head, because there's no one in my family who is from aviation background. And that era, that not many women pilots used to be there. So all I was like interested that, we just have to, or just put it down. Thanks. What I was saying, so I used to just sit down, at top of my ghar ka chhat whenever the light used to be off and there's no electricity at my Kharad. It's a very small town, if you must have heard about it. It's nearby Mohali. And I used to think that, I used to look at those airplanes flying roving overhead, because Chandigarh Airport is very close by and Kharad becomes a prominent place to hold for the aircraft. And I thought about that, I really want to fly these airplanes, how it must be to fly in one of these machines. And that is where it got instilled in me. And then I just couldn't stop myself, to achieve my dream. I'll share some stories, you know, for all of you, because just going through the journey will be a little more difficult and the time constraint we have, especially keeping the Women's Day in mind, that now we are, you know, talking about the women empowerment, inspiring women and aspiring women. Let me tell you, it's not that what you see today, that person, you know, I'm talking to you right now as an so-called inspirational woman. It wasn't like that. It's not that I have not gone through my low phases and the things which people used to see. You know, when, for example, I tell you, like when I was in school, my principal in the assembly, he instructed everyone that, you know, everyone must write something like a quote or the aim for their life on the notebook. For me, I just wrote that I want to fly in the sky. This is what I have written on all my notebooks in the first page, jump in arm class section, like out there. And one day our science teacher, he was just going through the, he was checking the notebooks and he was reading, you know, what people have, the students have written. And then it was my turn and then my notebook. And he's like, he read it, that I want to fly in the sky. And like, so he said, that remark actually is very fresh, though it was being said when I was like, in, I think eighth or ninth standard. Like, Jassi ji, pankhon ke saath udenge ya pankhon ke bina udenge? To say something like this, coming from a teacher, you know, and in front of the class, I felt something there. Like, why is he talking like this? You know, I obviously it wasn't a very good feeling, but let me tell you, I think that was that one remark made me even stronger. My decision to become a pilot even more stronger. That, yes, I will definitely fly. And I actually stood up, you know, I stood up and I said, sir, pankho na ho, main udungi. So, aapki life mein bhi, there will be people, you know, if you have a dream, you might tell people that, oh, I have this dream. And there will be very few who will actually understand that, okay, you know, and they'll support you maybe. They'll say, yes, you can do it, whether it's your family or a friend or even a stranger. But let me tell you, there will be many who will laugh at it. They're like, ah, ye karegi, especially if you're a girl, you know. Inke bas ki nahi hai. But one must not listen. Yahan se suno aur yahan se nikalo. You have to work hard. You have to make sure that finally, when you actually achieve that dream of yours, you know, it's the ultimate reply, right? That teacher knew later on when I wasn't even an airline pilot, when I just started flying, because after I finished my 12th, I was already in the flying school. And so then, you know, I was visiting or from, you know, from my sister, because my sister was also in the same school, I got to know that, oh, she has already joined a flying school. And much later, I met him again. And then he's like, oh, I'm really proud of you. And he also remembered that he made a remark, or maybe I actually told him so. Well, that is one. And then, you know, few more stories from the same journey, I would say, I tell you one more thing about being scared. Because, yes, dar har ko lagta hai, sab ko lagta hai. You know, और कहते हैं डर के आगे जीत है. आज, when I, you know, I'm a solo traveler. I really like to travel by myself. I have traveled to most of the Central Europe, North Europe, mostly Europe, and then, you know, Southeast Asia and Middle East. India में तो of course, India is like I go, I stay in the hotels. As a pilot, we have these layovers, where we just go and stay. And sometimes we have deputations. We have to go and stay for 10 days in a hotel. I start, I start calling these places my second homes, because I feel like home whenever I go there now, and I know people. And even when I travel and I stay by myself, all these places, and people are like, "Arey, tum akele chale jaati ho, tum akele ghumne jaati ho." Yes, I like to travel alone. It's okay. If my friends are ditching me, I already know. I said, this is my plan. You want to come join me? You don't have, but it's not a compulsion. So if you make your plan according to others, then definitely, there might be a disappointment. But if you make your own plan, there will be no disappointment. But let me tell you, the first time ever I have stayed in a hotel by myself, that was, so when I joined, when I went for my first airline job, that is Air Deccan, and that was in Bengaluru. So I cleared my written exam. So they told me at the end of the day that you have cleared your written exam, but you have to stay. The interview is tomorrow. And of course, I can't come back to Chandigarh or Delhi for that matter. And I had to spend the night over there. I haven't had that time the many friends at that time, who were there appearing for the same, job. And so somebody is like, "Arey, book out this hotel." So like a friend of mine from Delhi has told me, "Go there. There is one chota budget hotel. You book that." It was more like a service apartment kind of a thing, or two-star or three-star hotel. I booked that. And so in the evening, so after my dinner, I was already in my room. And I was kind of scared to hell that as if somebody gonna break down the door, come inside. And, literally, jo bhi furniture tha. So first I lock all the possible locks in the door. And I'm not kidding you. And even I laugh at it now that, I was like that at that time. And so I actually, put all the locks, and then whatever furniture, like those bedside table, and there was another table, I put in front of the door. And I had on speed, other those times, it was a normal Nokia phone, chota wala. That's, I'm talking about in 2006. So I had, speed dial 100, 100, like police. Agar koi aayega, main police ko call karungi. So, yeah. And then look at me now. Like, when I look at myself even now, that when I just go and I'm like, yeah, it's a hotel, and this room is good and that is good. And then I need a balcony wala kamara, things change. You feel as the time go by, you gain confidence. It's not that it is inbuilt thing. Nobody is inbuilt jhansi ki rani. Banna padta hai. So, ye sab cheezein hain. And then, of course, andar se aap jo, the basic nature, one must be, yes, fearless for sure. But be safe, be wise. I was wise at that time. For me, that time, that was my safe mechanism. Like, if I do this, this is the best thing to do right now. And, so while we say that, I'm just holding the phone right now. You know what? Let me tell you, we were trying the best thing. We were trying some really cool stuff to do. I had this tripod in front of me, and then there was this screen behind me, which is showing some pictures. But then I just realized now that I won't be able to see your face. And right now also, I can't see many faces. I can just see some pictures. I can see one Anipra right now. It is good to see people, I'm talking to people. Otherwise, I'm not very used to talking to a camera. Thank you so much, Manjeetji, and thanks everyone for turning on their cameras. So yeah, there are some pictures just running behind. Those are like my bachpan ka pictures. So about me, this is the small things I have had. Otherwise, about my journey, yes, starting from a small town, and then going in the flying school. Flying school was another thing. As a woman, I remember back in, it's around 2000 and all, I have no idea pilot kaise banna hai. I just know pilot banna hai. So I was there, and people who were there, my seniors, most of them were guys. They told me, you have come in the wrong profession. Not just because I was a girl, also because that time there were no jobs. You know, there was kind of a very slow down. The aviation sector was, there was nobody was hiring anyone. And telling something like this to a 17, 18 year old girl, who wouldn't even understand job kya hoti hai? I was like, no, job, it's okay. I just want to be pilot. I want to fly the plane. That's it. You know, ignorance is a bliss. Mujhe nahi pata tha that, you know, you actually need, you have to have a job. And my parents were kind of supportive. They couldn't support me as such, as far as the guidance is concerned related to the field, because my mom is a housewife. My father is a Punjab government servant. He was, now he's retired. And all he wanted me to do was that, you know, I must do engineering and then, you know, try for civil services. Because that was, you know, the typical of a Punjabi family, and especially, you know, papa wahan pe kaam kar rahe hain, bole ha ye cheez hai jahan main iski help bhi kar sakta hu maybe. But then I was very clear. So when I went for my CET exam, which my father pushed me through that you must go there, I was the happiest one coming out of the examination hall, because all I did there was inky pinky ponky. Yes, yeah. And but in the flying school, so that time in my flying school, there used to be just about, I would say, 15 total students. And at any point, you'll meet only four or five. And out of which I used to be like, there were three, including me, there were two more girls, two or three of us. But then they were my seniors. And then I haven't interacted with them as much. Mostly it were guys. Being in the school also, I was more like a tomboy, you know, that's the term we use. And in the flying school, I used to go in the bus, start from my home, which is in Kharar, take a bus to go to Chandigarh. From Chandigarh, take another bus to go to Pinjore. Then from Pinjore, take another bus or an auto rickshaw, which is shared wale, hathi, chota hathi or something like that, they call it. That one to go to the flying club. And sometime just sit there, don't do anything, no flying, because flying is something, you know, even for 30 minutes of a sortie, what we call, you must, you know, the weather and other things has to be good. And one of thing was the instructor ka mood. But I used to just be there, and you know, sometimes flying milti thi bada acha lagta tha, and then you know, I used to come back the same way. When I was in Karnal, I stayed in a PG for some time. And I'm telling you again why I was scared when I was in Bangalore, because while I was there in Karnal and I picked up a PG, and that was actually the very first time I was staying away. I was out from my house, from my home, and there something happened which kind of rattled me. So, you know, one day the owner's son and one of his friends, they came and they were knocking on my door, and I knew that day there was nobody at home. And they were like, oh, this is your Walkman. I used to have a Walkman. So they were having some cassettes. They're like, this is your cassette. I said, no, it's not mine. No, open the door. I said, no, I don't want to open the door. So, you know, when you're small, when you're young, these things, they just stay there in your head. But as I said, it's how, you must use your intelligence. Just not always be the let's just fight it out. Dimag sometimes chalana zyada zaruri hota hai. I was like, no, I'm not opening the door. Second thing I did is I called two, three more people. those who were there in the flying school. The next day, I was out from that place. And after that, I used to travel just because of this thing. I went back my home. I said, "Nahi, maine rehna hi nahi hai aise." I went back my home, Kharar, which was 145 kilometers from the flying club. I chose to travel this 145 kilometers almost every day because I used to take the bus and take this long route and come to flying club, take the airplane, fly the airplane from Karnal to Pinjor, land the plane there, because that time our flying club, which was my flying club, was Pinjor, was shut. So we have to have just 24-hour window in which we can take the plane wherever we want, but we have to come back. So I used to take the plane, fly the plane from Karnal to Pinjor, park the plane in Pinjor, take a bus from Pinjor, come to Kharar, which is about 60, 70 kilometers. Next day, within that 24-hour span, come, go back to Pinjor, take the plane, park it in Karnal, and then go home. So is it a struggle? Now I look at it, and when people tell me, yes, oh, you have struggled, it's really hard. But while I was doing it, to be honest, I never felt that it was a struggle. I was just doing it because I wanted to do it. And I felt that this is it. I was enjoying that journey. I just wanted, like, I used to feel so good when I used to fly that airplane. The first time in a pilot's life, two, three events hote hain jo bahut prominent hote hain. One is when the first time you fly, of course. When I first time I flew the airplane, the chota Pushpak, this is the picture, if like you can see there, you know, there, that's the plane. So this plane, when I saw it for the first time, that was actually, this is the first plane I ever saw up close and personal. Before that, I have never even sat down in a plane to go from A to B. I flew this aircraft. The first day was very good. I was scared also. Thoda wo, aise hota hai na, when you go on a roller coaster, you have this feeling that was there. But my instructors were there, really nice. And I tell you one more story about this now. You know, snake on the plane. Kis kis ne movie dekhi hai ye? Have you heard about snake on the plane? There's a movie. So I actually had a snake in my plane. This particular, you know, Pushpak aircraft. In the, yeah, yes, Amrita, great. So I was in the flying school and we were doing a circuit landing. Me and there was my instructor. I was very new. Or maine suna tha ki wahan pe sab bolte hain, Amrita, there are many snakes. Because flying schools, if you see, you know, most of the strips are like in a khet ved ke paas mein hote hain. So obviously snakes and all these reptiles, they are very frequent. I have never seen a snake, you know, in the flying school until that time. And doing this circuit landing, so we were you take off, you make a circle, then you come back and land. I saw the, you know, that Mali kuch kar raha hai. So he was having this ghas kaatne wala sword and he was just doing something. So my instructor, who was sitting with me at that time, said, just wait, let me just check. He went there, he saw, and then Tiger, both were, there was this very big snake, almost 6-7 feet long. And so neither these guys were, you know, like usko na kuch maar rahe the, na kuch kar rahe the, isse tang kar rahe. And then this snake start crawling like this towards my aircraft, towards the runway basically. And I was also curious to see ke dekhu dekhu kya hai. And I'm looking here on the left and down, and I can see the snake is coming. So this aircraft, you know, if you see the nose is up, so you can't see just below the, you know, nose. Ke kya hoga? So the next thing, obviously, I will turn to the other side. Kya bhi acha, abhi ye idhar se gaya hai aur yahan se ab nikal ke yahan se jayega. And the next thing I saw on the other side was my instructor shouting, "Jazzy, Jazzy!" Because from the propeller, might have the snake got some lift, and it was there in the window and going just like this much close from here, going that side. Oh, I was screaming my heart out, and I was like, have that headset and the shoulder hands. And I got trying to remove it. Oof, niklo, niklo, yahan se niklo. And bar instructors thinking ke ye to mere gale wale pe aa gaya hai, wahan se usko view wo mil raha tha. I just went out from the aircraft. So first is like, are you okay? Yes, I'm okay. So there, the snake actually went to the exactly, because this these planes are made of metal and fiber. पीछे से हॉलो होते हैं, वो पीछे उसके टेल कोन में चला गया, बाद में उसको निकाला गया. एंड नाउ नेक्स्ट डे व्हेन आई हैव टू टेक द प्लेन, आई वाज लाइक नो वे, व्हाट इफ देयर इज अ स्नेक, यू नो, दिमाग में बैठ गया अभी क्या करेंगे. सो देन वी गॉट अ लेक्चर यू नो फ्रॉम द चीफ फ्लाइंग इंस्ट्रक्टर. ही सेड यू नो ठीक है, यू नो, सो एज अ पायलट यू हैव टू डू अ वॉक अराउंड. सो वी वर डूइंग द वॉक अराउंड. And said walk around ke saath saath bandar bhi check kar liya karo jaane se pehle, before you take the aircraft out, kuch hai to nahi. Or even if it is there, kitne tomorrow if you're flying, let's say you are in the downwind, so which basically you're up in the air almost 1500 feet above ground, and you see udhar se snake aa raha hai side se nikal ke, don't be scared. Kitne saap se to maro na maro, सांप काटेगा शायद बच जाओगे, माई माइट नॉट बी पॉइजनस स्नेक, बट इफ एट ऑल यू गोना क्रैश द प्लेन, मेरा जहाज टूटेगा, तुम मरोगे. सो दैट थिंग, दैट स्नेक ऑन द प्लेन विच हैज हैपेंड विद मी इन माई फ्लाइंग स्कूल, एंड दिस लर्निंग दैट यू मस्ट फ्लाई द प्लेन नो मैटर वॉट, इवन होल्ड्स गुड टिल टूडे. When I fly this big machine, now maybe the snake is not literally the snake, it's not the real snake, but yeah, there are problems, you come, whether it's a technical issue while flying, or the weather, especially sometimes the weather is really vicious, and of course you feel a little bit scared, but you don't let that. As a captain, I am not allowed to have this scare of the snake overpower me. I must fly the plane. So this is what I would tell you all. Whatever problem comes in your life, don't be scared of it. Just, theek hai, dar hai, wo hai. That's a feeling. But you must know that you have to fly the plane. You are the captain of this ship, which must just stay up in the air, and it is you who will decide when and how to land it. So it's already 12:30, and we can have some questions from you.
Yes, I'm sure, Captain Jaswinder Kaur. Your passion was definitely visible. It was so infectious. And of course, you spoke everything in a very light-hearted manner, but you definitely have passed on a very strong message to all our participants. I would like to know now, Dr. Karuna Sinha and Dr. Pallavi Talekar, have our participants posed questions?
Yes, Dr. Manji, couple of questions have come in the chat.
Yes, box. Yes. So over to you, Dr. Karuna Sinha.
Yes. Ma'am, as you said, yes. Not to call you ma'am, but I will call you ma'am. Your talk was really an inspirational. What I like the most is that if you have your dream and passion, nothing can stop you from touching the stars. And fear may be there, but I do also believe dar ke aage jeet hai.
Perfect, yes.
So that is the takeaway. So I'll take up a couple of questions have come. We have one question which is asking that I too want to be in airlines as an air hostess. So I suppose she wants to know what she needs to do, to be there as an air hostess. Can you please throw some light on that?
So for an air hostess, actually, you know, you just have to do your graduation, though sometimes some people come after 12th also, but I must say having a done graduation is best. And then most of the airlines, see, there are two ways to go about it. One is that you can actually go and join these schools where they will teach you. They will, like Frankfurt is actually one of the very famous and the old one. And they'll give you training. And then there are some new training centers are also coming up. And another way is actually you can just go and just keep a lookout whenever there is a new vacancy coming in. So they put it on their social media, they put it on their website, just apply. And most of the time it's a walk-in interview. You know what, before becoming a pilot, because when I got my CPL after that, there was a time in between when I have to just sit at home and just so that I should be near to the planes. I remember applying for Air Sahara at that time. And I wore a sari and I went for an interview to be an air hostess. So these are mostly our walk-in interviews, most of the time in your city or the closer cities. Just go and be there. That's it. And then the rest of the training will be taken care of by the company. I hope I have answered the question.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. We have another question which has come from Shreya Pare. She's asking you, what was your biggest fear while flying?
Biggest fear while flying? As I said that, with the kind of training we go through, we just learn to, manage our fear. So then, at this point, you don't feel that any fear, any fear is big enough. That there are things which we respect, as I say, whether it's a weather or anything situation. But because of the training is so good, by the end of it, even in not just in while flying, even, otherwise also I have noticed that how I have changed and how I'm applying those tools in my personal life when I'm in a crisis.
Right, ma'am. Thank you once again. We have another question which is asking, what was your true experience, if I'm getting the question rightly, what was your true experience throughout your whole journey which you have taken away? What is your actual experience of your whole journey to look at from the beginning and where you are right now?
I would say that the whole journey so far is this only, that one must have a dream and one must pursue and one must work hard to achieve it. That's, and you will, utna sari kainat fir us cheez ko aap se milane mein jud jati. Otherwise, you look at me, nobody would imagine, even as I said, from my family, friends, aaj bhi, even till today, from my town, no one, there's not even a single pilot. And nobody even have thought about it. Ek ladki ek chote se shahar se nikal ke ek pilot banegi. So that's it.
Yes, very true. Very rightly said, ma'am.
And touch the
sky. And touch the skies. Yes, of course. Yes. Of course. Ma'am, another one is, what would be the basic educational criteria for joining the flying club?
So joining the flying club, basic criteria is 10 plus 2 non-medical stream. So you must have physics and maths. Those who have come from a different stream, whether arts or medical, well, medical, you already have physics. So you have to give exam. You can pass it from Open University also. Physics, maths, 10 plus 2. As if now, let me tell you, DGCA, which is our regulatory authority, they are planning now to change this qualification to graduation. But as of now, it is simple as 10 plus 2. Non-medical.
Oh, all right. Ma'am, another question talks about, Fariha Sheikh is asking, have you come across people saying, how can a woman fly a plane? As they usually say, women cannot drive.
Yeah, definitely. Yes, I have had these remarks where people were like, "Are," and let me tell you, so I'll show you one more picture. Maybe can you just put that, the all women crew. So sometime it happens that, you know, in the cockpit, the captain, that's me, and my first officer, both are girls. And then behind also, we have four girls, all women crew. And I do make an announcement also. I remember categorically one flight coming from Pune to Chennai, one passenger while boarding the plane, he saw that there were two ladies sitting in the cockpit. It's like, oh, so he made a remark to my crew and like, "These two ladies are going to fly the plane." And the crew came to me and said, "Captain," one guy is saying like this, and he's not like a, you know, oldie or something, huh? A young guy. And I said, "Just go and tell this person, yes, these two ladies are going to fly the plane. If he has any problem, he may get down here and maybe take a male pilot plane, but definitely then he has to buy a ticket." But by the end of the flight, he actually, you won't believe, so he wasn't feeling well or something, and then my crew has taken care of this person really good. And when we landed in Chennai, and I came out of the cockpit, he actually apologized for his comment, and he said he had a really good flight. So while yes, there are people who had these have had made these remarks, you know. So yeah, there's this picture. You can, if it is visible enough. So there's like all women said, "This is my goer." This thing next, just go on the next row. You see me in this next. Yeah, this is my, actually this is my first flight as a captain in King. I was back in 2011. And you can see there is only one Sardarji, who was my first officer and is also my best friend. So at the same time, I do get a lot of good comments, and you know, people write feedback when they hear a women's voice, and then it comes from all, you know, from men, women who are flying with, you know, with me as a passenger. And there are many, many feedbacks, and it feels really good. And when I tell them that, oh, the 2 days flight was an all women crew flight, because definitely it is still considered as a man's job.
Thank you, ma'am. And we really feel proud of you.
Thank you.
So last question in the chat box is from Amrita. She's asking, I'm sure one part of the question you have answered, how can one focus on working on work while fighting fear? For example, flying a plane, but not letting problems hinder.
SOPs, standard operating procedures, following that helps a lot. You know, so as I said that, if we have any problem, let's just say I'm flying a plane and there is some technical issue. Let's just say engine failed. Fine, I have been trained. So having a good training, so when I say training, let's just say teaching for you guys, you know, whatever life teach us and our teachers, you know, because you guys are, you know, there are students right now listening to me. Let me tell you, your teachers are teaching you something. Please pay attention. Yeah, these are the wise which you're gonna, you know, use it in your life to handle this fear. How to handle is this only. So we have technical knowledge, and we go through these training sessions, we go through our checks. So that's why it doesn't matter. Even in my training, the first thing was told to me when I went is like, if engine is on fire, it's okay. The fire was inside the engine. That is why the engine was running. If the fire shut off, you say engine failed. If the fire is outside the engine, you say its engine is on fire. But that's all right. The problem is there, but the solution you must know.
So sweet of you. Manjeet ma'am, there are two more questions have come up. Should I take up?
Yes, six? yes, surely.
One is, I'm sure that is something very personal, but you can, ma'am, definitely give an idea about that. What is the salary of captain, ma'am? Usual salary.
See, the usual salary before COVID or after COVID? So before COVID, the captain would earn anywhere from 6 to 6 to 8 lakh per month. And now after after this COVID, the salaries has gone down for as much as would say 40%, but we are hoping that it'll come back to the same what it used to be.
Very true. Another question is talking about who or what motivated you to have this as your dream?
Sorry?
Who or what motivated you to have this as your dream?
I mean myself. And I'm not kidding you. No one. I was just sit down. Main aise upar chota bachcha dekhta hai na, the plane dekhta hai. So everyone look at the plane. I just dreamt that I want to fly the plane. I want to sit on the very first seat and fly it myself. So yes, maybe you can call it, she's being arrogant, but yeah, I motivated myself.
You who has to have a dream, correct?
Yes.
Ma'am, I must read the appreciation. Ma'am, it was very amazing and awesome meeting you and knowing you nearly. Then can we get your Instagram ID?
Yes, of course. So what I do now, I'm going to turn the camera the other way down and then you can have a look. And then maybe I can just, okay, here. So that's my Instagram. That is Pilot Jessie Great, GR8. See? And can we zoom in? So here it is. I hope you can see it.
Yes, it is visible.
That's kind of like my, there are some pictures from, can I do it, or are you doing it? No, I don't want to be in the seat, I want to be in the profile. No, thanks. Oops. Here. That's my life. Kind of like a bit of it. I put it there for all of you. You can just have a look and, can follow me. So I'm a very different personality. It's not just one thing. I like to cook because the power of shoes, which is I got it done in back in 2014. And I've come a long way, let me tell you. I was also that little geeky. My daddy used to tell me not to wear ye choti choti dresses that my daddy did. Coming from choti jagah, values and all, and then that's my mom, dad. And so you can follow me. And before I end it, I actually have a very nice poem, which I really like. If I can, if they just like
actually there minutes. Are some I one, think there one, are some questions.
Yes.
More one, questions.
Yeah, one question has come from our principal ma'am.
Yes, please.
Madam,
can we have you on the screen, Captain Jessie?
Am I there?
Yes.
You're there, ma'am. So one question has come from our principal, ma'am. Madam, why we focus on things like all women crew, patrol pump, police force, and so forth? Why not we concentrate on agenda like unisex group and avoid hurting male or female ego?
Can you just repeat the question?
When we can have unisex restrooms?
I'm totally in for that. To be honest, when they say female pilot, I'm sorry, a pilot is a pilot. Airplane doesn't know whether it's a male or a female, And washroom se yaad aaya, whenever there is so much of rush on the girl side, I just go and bye, go to the, I see, acha koi nahi hai, idhar male washroom mostly khali rehte hain, I just go there and I definitely agree to principle, ma'am. And, you know, I am actually, I'm for equality, you know, and where there is no difference, you know, between a male and a female. That's the world I think we must all cater for. We are celebrating a Women's Day, of course. Now there is a Men's Day also. How many people will know when it's Men's Day? Nobody knows. Sometime they will just get a message, oh, today is a Men's Day. 8th March, International Women's Day, everyone knows. Iski zarurat kyun padi? I would say, male pehle se yahan the. Women have been always put down. Now with all these things, which are like, whether, you know, talking about women empowerment, whether, you know, having a Women's Day and all these things, we are trying, you know, feminism is more like, you know, we're trying to raise women and to make it equal and where there will be no difference. Where I need not to tell, oh, I'm a female pilot. That is why I'm special. I am special because I'm a pilot.
Captain, our principal ma'am has sent thanks for your open answer.
Yes, thank you. I think, Karuna ma'am, you have taken all the questions. I would just like to ask, Pallavi, Dr. Pallavi.
Ma'am, over to you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Karuna. Dr. Pallavi, are there any questions in the chat box?
Yes, Dr. Manjeet, there are a couple of questions on WhatsApp also. So good afternoon, Captain Jasvinder. There's a question for you. It says, what was the most difficult decision you made as a pilot?
As a pilot? Most difficult decision as a pilot, as in an airline pilot? Can you just...
Yes. Airline pilot.
I really can't remember as such because, you know, we take decisions almost every day. And, to say that the most difficult, sometimes the most difficult decisions are the one, you know, where you see the flight is getting delayed and, you know, there is someone who needs to be there at a particular time and then you really can't help it. And you have to divert, you know, because the weather was just not good. And, you know, there are people who would like to land maybe just at Delhi, but you have to go to Lucknow because Delhi weather is really bad. That's a bit of a difficult decision.
Thank you. There's another question by Ami. She's asking how to be motivated in any difficult situation.
To remain positive, to see that there is a light at the end of the tunnel. Always remember that. Remember that even if you see that your life is shadowed, you have a shadow on your whole life and you know you feel like, oh, it's dark. Remember one thing. That shadow is cast only when there is a light. Without light, there will be no shadow. So there is always a silver lining. There will be always something, you know, good with the bad. So that if you have that hope, then you will be motivated. You will stay focused. You will be, nahi, theek hai. Yeh bhi bura chal raha hai. Aisa nahi hai, you know, like my life is all la la land. No, even I have had, you know, up and down. And it is okay to be sad also. It's okay to feel low. That's all right. But must not stay there, must come out. Take help, you know, to for that, you know, if it's not enough for myself. You know, I will talk to my friends, my family, talk about it. But remember, shadow tabhi hota hai jab light hoti hai. There is no light, no shadow.
Thank you for focusing on the positivity. There's one more question, but when you were answering in a flow somewhere, you have touched, you have given the answer. The question is, did you face any gender discrimination in your profession? If so, how did you face it? Somewhere you have told one incident which is related to the passenger.
I'm really happy that you have asked. I'm really happy that you've asked this question. So let me tell you, aviation for that matter is one profession as a pilot, you know, where the gender bias is really, you know, not there. When Principal Ma'am said now about the equality, I would say aviation is one sector where there is no gender bias. My pay package, my chances of career progression are same as, you know, a male pilot. Whereas definitely there are industries where for the same job, if you're a woman, you're paid less. So though there are very less women in flying as a pilot, but the gender bias is not there at all. In the classroom, if there will be like 20 students, we call ourselves also a student when we sit in a class, we have these, you know, yearly or something. I could be the only one girl. I was the only one woman sitting there among all these male pilots, but there's no discrimination. And in fact, they know how to behave a little better.
Oh, Vishal.
Thank you, ma'am, for bringing again, focusing on the equality, which is there in the film. So there were only these three questions on WhatsApp. Thank you, Manjeet ma'am. It's over to you.
Thank you, Pallavi.
Manjeet ma'am.
Yeah, yes, Karuna, madam.
Anita ma'am has sent a message for ma'am.
Yeah, sure. Please read it out.
Just small message she has said. Anita ma'am, we have got a message from Anita ma'am for you, ma'am. These days we have women pilots in Air Force. Great women power. All the best, madam.
Thank you so much. Yes, now women are soaring. Now things are changing, especially in India, I must say. We have the highest percentage for women, which is almost now reaching 15 to 18%. Though, you know, when I go to Europe and all these places, the so-called developed countries, there the women pilots are still just about, 3 to 5%. So I must say, Bharat ki beti, you know, sabse aage badh rahi hai.
Lovely, very nice. Yes, if time would have permitted, we would have continued listening to yours.
Definitely,
story.
As I said, I really want Captain. To, you know, recite these few lines from the poem, which I hope, all the girls are going to love it. This is specially written and, you know, by one of my friend, Chandrima Deshmukh, and the book is called A Teaspoon of Stars. The poem name is Fly. So let me just read out, can you just help me with holding the... Let me just turn around this. Okay. Hi, everyone. So before I say goodbye to you, here's a poem. It says, fly. As I'm a pilot, of course. And they will suggest, tone down your love, the language, the laughter. They will scare you with talks or repercussions, risks. They will try to tame you with calm down, don't overreact. They will make you feel uncomfortable in your own skin with blood boiling beneath. And here is what you do when that happens. Hold both your palms together. Look closely. So basically, what you do is hold both her palms together, look closely. What you see is a pair of wings in flight. There is a reason your destiny is windshield. Fly. Thank you.
That was wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Captain Jesse. And now... For the formal vote of thanks, I hand over the dais to Dr. Archana Kadgari.
Thank you, Mandita. A very good afternoon, each one of you. The flight with Airbus A320, with gorgeous Jaswinder Kaur as our captain, was very exciting and lively. Ma'am, your story is indeed captivating and very stimulating for all those young girls out to take their flight high and live their dreams. It is definitely the time to break those stereotypes when it comes to career and women. The message by you, ma'am, to be fearless and confront our own fears, come face to face, is most important. How we handle our fears will determine where we go with the rest of our lives. Ma'am, we all are so proud of you and your achievements. On behalf of our management, Gujarat Research Society, our principal, Dr. Anita Swami Ma'am, the entire HSE family, and the participants, I take this opportunity to propose the vote of thanks. We are extremely grateful to Captain Jaspinder Kaur for sharing her life experiences and spending your valuable time with us today. Ma'am, there is one more message from our principal, madam. I'll just share that with you. Just a minute, ma'am.
Yeah. Because that was I passed on to Manjeet, ma'am. Huh?
Okay. So,
but you can.
No. Please, Archana. Please go ahead.
Yeah,
and share.
I just happened to see that.
Yes.
Ma'am, our principal, ma'am, has requested you to send us your selfie with aircraft you fly on 8/3/21. That is on the Women's Day, as a memoir for our college.
Definitely, I'll do that.
Once again, ma'am, thank you so much for being with us.
I am really not a motivational speaker. I'm just a storyteller, as I said that before, you know. And it was lovely talking to all of you. And thanks, you know, I'm feeling really humble and blessed that, you know, for all hearing you people out for me. And wishing all of us a very happy Women's Day.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for joining us. Thank you.
See you.
Manjeet, ma'am, unmute yourself.
Yes, it's time now to move on to our third star. Would be taking us again on another journey to the stars. And I would request Dr. Usha Gorkar to introduce this star, Dr. Namita Chaudhary, to all
of
us.
Thank you, Dr. Manjeet. A very warm good afternoon to one and all. Our next speaker for the day is a dynamic personality who has more than 20 years of experience as an academician in the field of medicine. She's a brilliant surgeon with specialization in laparoscopy and endoscopy, and she has worked widely with various NGOs for the upliftment of women and betterment of women education, Dr. Namita Chaudhary. Dr. Namita Chaudhary has completed her MBBS from Nayar Medical College and her MS from Sion Hospital. Her career as a medical academician began with D.Y. Patil Medical College as a postgraduate teacher for general surgery, where she trained postgraduate students for MS general surgery. Dr. Namita has also been professor and head of surgery at ESI Postgraduate Medical College and has continuously updated herself with newer technologies for improvisation of medical education. Dr. Namita has also been associated with the Medical Council of India for assessment and regulation of medical colleges throughout the country. Known for her positive and motivational attitude towards life, Dr. Namita has always been an inspiration for her patients and all those with whom she interacts. I can personally vouch for this as we are the alumni of the same school. And Dr. Namita, being my senior and captain in the student council of the school, we always looked up to her. Even today, as a family friend, we always admire and are fascinated by Dr. Namita's fighting spirit and enthusiasm. I find that her patients always come out of her consulting room smiling and with renewed zeal for life. But as much as she loves her patients, she's also a passionate animal lover. So if you get invited to her house and you may meet an iguana or a python, also cats, turtles, white mice, and the list goes on and it keeps on changing too. I'm sure all of you must be wondering what an interesting person Dr. Namita is and what will she be talking to us today? That we shall soon find out. Without further ado, I, Dr. Usha Borkar, on behalf of our parent body, Gujarat Research Society, our principal ma'am, Dr. Anita Swami, all faculty colleagues and the participants to this webinar from all over the country, extend a warm welcome to you, Dr. Namita. We are extremely grateful and honored by your presence here today. With this, I request Dr. Namita Chaudhary to commence with your talk. Over to you, Dr. Chaudhary.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much, Usha, for this wonderful, wonderful introduction. I don't think I have been introduced so fabulously ever in my life. Thank you so much. And I especially want to thank the organizers, the association for inviting me. I am a very ordinary person and I feel very humbled to be in front of this august audience who comprise of all teachers. My mother was a teacher, so I hold a special place in my heart for the teachers, and I'm so humbled that I'm able to talk to all of you. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. So I was asked to narrate my story as a surgeon, and there's really nothing much, it began with a very simple thing. You know, I was sitting in a theater, I was watching this movie. You people would not even have heard of this movie. This movie was called Dard Ka Rishta. It starred Smita Patil and Sunil Dutt. They both are, you know, they are couple doctors, and they decide to get divorced because the husband says, you stay back and look after the family. And the wife says, you know, I have to go to the US to do my research. And she leaves the country, she goes. And years later, Sunil Dutt, now remarried, and he has a daughter, and the daughter suffers from blood cancer. And he takes her to US because he's told that the specialist for blood cancer is in the US. And he enters the room and he sees his wife there standing, his ex-wife. She's wearing a white coat and she's a picture of, you know, confidence and empathy. And she looks at him and she says, welcome, sir, and I'm here to save your daughter. That persona which was there, that made such an impression on my hand, on my heart and my mind. And I decided I'm also going to wear this white coat and save the world. So that was then. But by the time I finished my 10th, I realized that the only reason why I joined medicine was because I was very bad at maths. I could not handle maths. I could not handle physics. So to run away from these two subjects, I decided, chalo PCB karte, physics to kisi tarah manage ho jayega. And after 12th, I don't have to open my physics textbook. So I decided, okay, let me do math. Let me do medicine. And that's how I started studying for MBBS. I was an average student. And only thing I used to be good at long hours of studies. So I guess that was the reason why I finished my MBBS very nicely. And parents were very supportive. I'm lucky to be born to very supportive and very positive parents. I finished MBBS, and back then we used to have this concept of subject marks. So being a girl, being a lady, we all would obviously be, you know, very attracted to gynecology because we deal with women. But somehow I was very impressed with the surgeons. And I liked, you know, when I used to see, one small thing was that all surgeons were really good looking. So we used to see these handsome surgeons come out of the OT with all, you know, bloody gloves, and then come and tell the patients, oh, the surgery was good and your patient is fine. And that used to be very rewarding. Even as a student, it used to be very rewarding. So I was very, very attracted to surgery, but theek hai, humne padhai kiya gynec ke liye. And like all elders say, na ki beta jo hota hai acche ke liye hota hai. We studied so much for gynec, but I performed miserably in gynec. So I got very low marks. And I was in a way happy that, you know, chalo gynec se chutkara mila. And my mother told me it's better that you go and consult a senior surgeon, ask them, because we had no background of medicine in our family. So I went to this very senior surgeon who was supposed to be a role model to all of us. He was my role model too. He is still. So I asked him, I said, sir, what should I pick up as my postgraduate subject? I said, he asked me, what is your preference? I said, I'm very attracted to surgery. And immediately the person himself was a surgeon. And immediately he said, no, 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 beta, that's a wrong choice for a girl. It's not right. It involves a lot of hard work, physical labor. Ladkiyon ki bas ki baat nahi hai ye. And moreover, I think you should take up something like, you know, anesthesia or medicine, so that you can get married to a surgeon, an orthopedic surgeon or a physician. So you have a wide choice for marriage. So take some complementary branch. Don't bother with surgery. And I really didn't know how to react. That, I think, was the first time when I realized that I'm a lady, I'm a woman, and I'm supposed to be disadvantaged because I'm a woman. Because my parents brought me up as a human being. They never told me you're a girl or a boy. And I came back home and I told my mom, is it really true that I can't survive? I won't be able to do? And she said, no, it's not like that. What is it that you cannot do that the other person will do? You can work for 24 hours. You don't need sleep for 3 days. So it's all right. Go ahead. And I was so thankful to my mother. I was so upset with what my senior told me. So I decided, ki no. Now, whatever happens, I shall go into surgery. And as my good stars, I got surgery in Sion Hospital. Now, at that time, Sion Hospital used to be a very, very heavy hospital, as we would call it. We used to have a lot of patient load because we had a trauma unit, which was the single trauma unit from Bombay to Pune. And we used to get a lot of these accidents. So working in Sion was supposed to be very difficult. Lots of working hours, as in 7 days without sleep, without food, we would all be working. And I joined in, and that's a very interesting incident. You know, I had this expensive stethoscope that had presented me because I got surgery, and I took that stethoscope. I didn't know that, you know, in a general hospital with so much of work and running around, you tend to leave the stetho somewhere and it gets flicked very easily. You lose the stetho. And nobody carries an expensive stethoscope because it's definitely going to be robbed. So I was taking my rounds and this young fellow comes from the other ward and he's my co-houseman, he's my colleague. And he says, Namita, apna stetho do na. My senior has come for rounds and he's asking for the stetho. So I said, le lo jao. 10-15 minute ke baad, he comes back and he returns and he's laughing. I said, what happened? Why are you laughing? He said, you know what my senior commented on your stethoscope? I said, what? He asked me, who does this expensive stetho belong to? So I told him, there is this girl who has joined surgery and it belongs to her. So he said, acha, this girl is carrying this expensive stetho. Doesn't she know that this stetho will get robbed immediately? Let me tell you, in 15 days, the stetho will get robbed, it will disappear. And on the 16th day, so will this girl. She will not be able to survive in Sion. So I just kept quiet and I just took my stetho back and I just went on doing my work. And sure enough, on the 15th day, I lost my stetho. Somebody flicked it. But I stayed in surgery and I married the same guy. And I'm now in his life for the last 25 years. That was the first time when I proved that I'm here to stay. Then started our regular, you know, training and things. And everybody used to get chance to operate, especially on emergency nights, you know, at 2 in the night, 3 in the night, you know, we used to be called for surgery. And I used to wonder, okay, why am I not being given a chance to operate? So one day I asked my senior, I said, why don't you give me a chance to operate in the night in the emergency? And he said, no, we are scared. You're a girl. You will faint or, you know, fall down because you've been working the whole day. I said, but Have I ever fallen down? Have I ever fainted? No, but you can. But you can. I mean, there was so much of assumptions that if being a girl, you will faint, you will not be able to cope up. And I would just listen to all this and keep on working. That time, because we were very junior, we never had the guts to, you know, refute the seniors or answer back to the seniors. But it definitely used to bother us. Anyways, we continued things. Then slowly they saw how persistent I was, how this thing, and then things fell into place. Then the next experience that we had was when we used to sit in the OPDs, you know. In the OPDs, we would sit and the patients would come in and they would look at me and, sister, kidhar jaane ka hai, kaun se doctor ko dikhane ka hai? I mean, even the patients, you know, would assume that lady hai to wo sister hi ho sakti hai. She cannot be a doctor and she cannot be a surgeon in the first place. And I would like get very angry, you know. Tumko dikhta nahi hai, main doctor hoon, kya takleef hai? And they would still very reluctantly tell me, you know, nahi, hum wo doctor ko dikha denge kya? And even after they showed me, I wrote everything and I told them, they would get it counter-checked by the other person. So initially it used to bother me so much. I used to get very annoyed and every OPD I used to come back very frustrated. Then one day I spoke to my senior. She was 3 years senior to me and I asked her, I said, did you go through all this? How did you start, you know, coming out of this? And she said, just do your work. Your performance should be guided by the purpose. You are here to learn surgery, learn it. Don't worry about these fringe opinions and fringe reactions. Focus on your patient, focus on your studies. Don't try to refute the popular beliefs. Your actions will refute them on their own. And that sort of, I agreed to it, that I needn't waste my time shouting back at them. I needn't waste my time trying to explain anything. I just have to do a good job. I have to see them properly. I have to treat them properly. I have to operate them properly. Then my anxieties came down a little bit when I was settled in the life. But you know, a married life brings a whole lot of new problems, new expectations. When you're courting, your expectations from your spouse is different. But when you're married, the expectations are different. And the biological clock is also ticking. And the career clock has also started running. And the biological clock and the career clock usually are always, you know, in conflict with each other. The same time as you want your career to start booming, you also have to make a family, give birth to kids, raise the kids, take care of in-laws, take care of your old parents. So it's a whole big confusing status. And you're not very old, you're still in the learning phase. So you join a hospital, you are given duties because you are senior, you have emergencies, surgeries last for a long time. So you cannot leave surgeries and come back home in the middle if I get a call. So it used to be a little tiring. And coupled with that, the important thing was that you could not complain. Because everybody thinks ki for a woman, a career is an option. It is not a necessity, unlike that of a man. You know, a man's career is necessity. So all the importance is given to him so that he is able to pursue his career properly. But for a woman, she's made to realize at many stages that you could give up this and concentrate solely on the home front. So I thought about this and I decided that I would have my children before I actually start my independent surgery career. So I had two kids, 4 years apart. And till then I was in a low profile job which did not, you know, demand too much out of me. But because those kind of refined adjustments we need to make so that we have a long and a sustained career. So I took a little bit of backseat. I had my two children. And then I stepped out. I understood, you know, you have to have a good backup. You should have a good army. You can't be a one-man army, especially if you're pursuing a career or a profession which demands your 100% attendance. Let me give you an example. This incident happened with me. My son was three and a half years old. He had joined Delhi Public School in the nursery. And I was operating, I was doing a kidney operation. There was a stone in the kidney and I was removing the stone. And just as I removed the stone, there was a little bleeding from the kidney and I was trying to control it. So that's a critical point during the operation where you have to, otherwise the patient might bleed to death. So you have to control the bleeding. So it was a very critical point and I was fully focused on that. And I got a phone call, means the anesthetist who was attending to my patient, he picked up the call and said, Namita, your crash lady has called up saying that your son hasn't returned from the school. And I was stunned at that point of time. I was stunned because I used to stay in Nerul and I was operating in Ghatkopar. I was like 45 to 1.5 hours away from Nerul. I just we put a cover on the kidney to just hold the bleeding. And it took me around 30 seconds to calm myself down. And I said, please tell me again, what is the situation? He said, your crash lady has called up saying that Darsh hasn't returned home. He hasn't come back from school because the school bus did not carry him. And I sort of, you know, just focused my mind and I told the anesthetist, please inform Sally Santi that it's all right. I will look into the matter. I was in Ghatkopar. My son was in Nerul. I was really shaken up for 10 seconds. And then I closed my eyes and I prayed. I said, Bhagwan, mere bache ko sahi rakhna. And I lifted up the mop. I completed the surgery. I closed up the incision. From the time of the phone call, to the time I was free was around 40 minutes. And I had no clue what is happening to my son. There was no way I could leave my surgery and go. And my husband at those times, he was in Taiwan. He had gone to Taiwan for a fellowship. So I was the only contact person. I finished the surgery. And the point is that I had to finish the surgery and wait for the patient to come out of anesthesia and inform the relatives that your patient is safe. So it was a good 45 minutes till I could actually walk out of the theater. And while I was changing back to my clothes, ready to leave, I get a call from the school that your son has come back he entered the wrong bus. So he went to Vashi and he's come back and he's now at the school and he's safe. So please come and pick him up. And I have never thanked God enough for that window period of 45 minutes where he kept my son. So, you know, then I took I had a car, but I was too scared to drive the car. So I just took a cab. I went, I picked up my son. My son was crying. He was upset with me that mommy didn't come early, but I could not help it. Then I took him back. So, you know, this kind of an incident, I mean, any other person would have thought the worst. You know, any other profession, you can drop it at an instant and run and go back. I could not do that at that point of time. So, you know, these kind of incidences make you realize that you cannot be a one-man army. And you need a good backup system. It may be your in-laws, it may be your parents. For me, it was a maid that I picked up. She was extremely good. She's still with me for the last 21 years. And she's the backbone of my house. So I created a team for myself. You know, in my team, there was a bhajiwala who was always available on the phone, a stationary person who was always available on the phone, autowala who was always available on the phone if my children have gone somewhere and my maid experiences any problems. And my creche auntie. I invested a lot of time in the first 3 years post-marriage and, you know, when all these things, I invested a lot of time in finding a good creche for my son and subsequently my daughter so that, you know, he is in a protected environment when I'm not there. So these small things you need to arrange well so that, you know, because your career, it's not a matter of option. It's a matter of financial independence and a sense of purpose to your life. It's very essential for a homemaker also to have a purpose in her life. It's not about me being a surgeon. It's about me being a woman. We are valuable people. A homemaker is valuable for that home. And she must give herself the due respect. So I had to face a lot of barbs, you know, from the family, from friends, behind my back, my society ladies, you know, in the evening, they would see me rushing in and out of the house. Isko to paise ki itni padi hai ki she leaves her son to her maid. They don't understand that it is not about the money. It is about the independence. So these kind of barbs were always, I was blind and deaf and dumb to them. That was different. But this kind of situation taught me the concept of, you know, delegation of power, the concept of having a team to work with. So even when at 10 in the night, you know, at 9 in the night, my daughter would call up, Mama, I want a chart paper and kal subah chart paper chahiye. I would call up the stationery guy, please jaake society ki security guard ko chart paper de do. So that used to help me tide over these small problems where the mother is blamed. And unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, I would say fortunately, the child always calls for the mother. They never phone up their fathers. I mean, at least in my situation, it was like that. Never call up dad and say, Dad, I want crayons, I want sketch pens. It will always be, Mama, crayons chahiye, sketch pen chahiye, brown paper chahiye. So I would have these people on my team so that the daily things would not get hampered. This is how I attempted to balance my profession. I understood the demands of my profession and the demands of my family. Now the choice was mine to have a family. It's all right if you don't want a family. That is perfectly fine. There a few of my colleagues have got married but have not had kids because they said we want to focus completely on the career, which is perfect. But if I have decided that I should have a child, the family should not be an excuse for my work, and my work should not be an excuse for my family. I cannot tell my son that I cannot spend time with you because I'm working. And neither can I tell my patients that I don't have time to operate on you because I have a son who's not well at home. So this kind of balance has to be reached. All said and done, this balance we try to maintain to the best of our capacity, but there are tips and turns, you know. When I would, my school nurse would call up, you know, your son is having high grade fever and please come and pick him up. And I would have to tell them, wait, you let the son be in the school, let him finish his school time, please send him in the bus and his creche will pick him up. Because it's not possible. And at that time, my son would hate me. He would hate me for it. He would say, Mama, you don't love me. And I would have no words to comfort him, because at that point of time, whatever I say will sound as an excuse, because he says, "Uski mama to aa gayi, usko leke gayi, aap hi nahi aaye." So those things you have to swallow. It is a bit of the poison. That is what you learn from Shankar Bhagwan. You know, ki wo poison hume lena padta hai thodi bahut. That is something you have to have, you know, sacrifices. Yes, the excuse creates a disbalance. You can't give an excuse. Like, you know, in my workplace, if I try to tell them ki, you know, tomorrow I have a function at home and my mother-in-law wants me to be there, and they say, immediately the colleagues' reactions would be, iske le ladies logon ko na ye lena nahi chahiye. They would not react in a supportive manner. There is no connection. Even if the male colleague had to go for the function, he would have to take a half day and go. But that is all right. It's not all right for me. Every time it comes back to that, अरे तुमको करना नहीं चाहिए था ना, तुमसे होता नहीं है. तो यू डोंट हैव द लग्जरी ऑफ यू नो गिविंग एन एक्सक्यूज और गिविंग एन एक्सप्लेनेशन. बट ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम, यू नो, विथ योर एंड अदर थिंग्स विच बॉदर यू, यू नो, इफ आई एम टेकिंग अ राउंड एंड आई एम, you know, teaching something to my juniors and they haven't done something properly, and I shout at them, I can hear them in the back saying, lagta hai aaj madam ki na maid aayi nahi hai ghar pe, iske liye chidchid kar rahi hai. It's always, you know, in that ridiculing manner. And if the same thing has happened with a male colleague, sir must be having a busy day ahead, that is why he must be. So it's always for the males, it is always an important agenda which is bothering them, and for the females it is always this trivial thing called, you know, ghar mein maid nahi hai iske liye madam ka mood acha nahi. All these things used to bother me, but over a period of time, you know, you realize that it is futile to waste your time trying to talk and change them. You have to do things and then change them. So you know, this tip to these to a small tip to the working women is that have a good workforce, you know, in tandem with your profession, so that these small things can be taken care of. And if you take care of these small things, the family feels cared for. Of course, it is not an option for the proper physical time that you spend with your child. So that was another career decision that I made, that I took a back step in private practice. I joined a government institution so that I would have restricted time hours. Okay, so the restricted time hours would help me get time to take care of my children, their studies. So if ambition is extremely important and extremely good, but if you decide to also have a family, then you have to strike that balance. So that was my decision, to step back a little bit in my private practice so that I could have some good amount of time with my children. And that's how life just progressed. Everything, I got the hang of it, how to balance my life, how to, you know, keep the family happy. Not that I was, you know, 100% successful in everything. I mean, if you ask my son, he might say, ki mama was never, she's not a very good mother. Or if you ask my daughter, she'd say, ha, theek hai, mama is around, but I wish she was around for more time. You ask my mother-in-law, she would like, nahin, theek hai, soon karte kaam, but she could have done more. So obviously everybody has their own, you know, list of expectations which they expect you to fulfill. But for me, I thought, you know, that making a roti doesn't define me. Washing clothes does not define me. What defines me is my character and what I'm capable of doing. When I'm at my deathbed, I want to die with good memories. I don't want to die with regrets or, you know, dreams which were unfulfilled. So we have to give due importance to ourselves and our abilities. It is extremely foolish to sacrifice your abilities and capabilities for a family to the extent where you lose your self-confidence. Sacrifice is good, but it should not compromise on your soul. If I am a good surgeon and I just give up surgery because my children are small, it's an insult to my person. You can and you will be able to manage both, because you know, tomorrow when your children grow up, they go to their places of work. Your husband is there, he's finished his thing. He has a lot to tell you about, maine ye kiya, maine wo kiya. Then you wonder, ki fir maine kya kiya? So, believe me when I tell you that you can have it all. Only thing is, not at one time. You will have to get everything at regular intervals. So, a little bit of sacrifice, but a lot of motivation, lot of hard work put in, and you will be able to sail through life. You should not give up your career if that is what you are passionate about. Having said this, I have full and complete respect for homemakers, because homemakers have a full-time job. It's not easy. We are able to cut down our jobs, and we are able to balance both the sides because we are able to cut down the job. So a homemaker is a fabulous person, you know. So even that, you have to have that respect for yourself. If you don't respect yourself, nobody will. You're a homemaker, and I'm very proud of the fact that we are homemakers. We are available and responsible for a whole family, family's convenience, family's growth. Because I am there, that is why my family is growing. So it's a great sense of honor. So, you know, there is, all of us are wonderful. And my main point is that I believe that, you know, I don't blame the men for distinguishing women and men. This distinction has been done by God. He has created man, he has created woman. And what did God do? He called woman the Shakti. So it has already been branded by God that women are all powerful. She is Shakti. We don't really have to prove this to the man. We just have to quietly do our work. Please understand this fact. We are Shakti. A man is not called Shakti. We are called Shakti. Hum Shakti hai. So we should celebrate ourselves. We are Shakti and we can do everything. That is what I realized from my life. So all this happened and I was doing well. And sometime, you know, I was operating on a lot of women with breast cancers and all. And there were these 2 weeks where I operated on 3 ladies who were my age and who had breast cancer. And I thought one at home when I was, you know, I was at home in the night, I was thinking, I said, all these 3 ladies are my age. Maybe I should check myself and find out whether I have a lump. And as you would call it, luck or whatever, I detected a lump in my breast and I immediately got it checked and everything, and it turned out to be breast cancer. And I was 42 years old that time. Now I'm 49. I was 42 years old. My son was in the 6th. My daughter was in the 2nd standard. And I was like, oh, so I have breast cancer. And I, again, it was for a half a day that I was disturbed. And then I just said, okay, let me just take the treatment. Let me finish the treatment. And I complimented myself. You know, good, you have taken it well, that you will go ahead with your treatment. And now the only thing that remains is that I should make my 2 children independent enough, because, you know, the treatment is long. You don't know what happens in the treatment, during the treatment, while you're getting operated. Any surgery has complications or whatever. Chemotherapy is painful. So I was thinking, what is the single most important thing that I need to do at this point of time? you know, considering the mental thought which comes to your mind, cancer is equal to a limited lifespan. Or kitne din baki hai, you know, that is all the movies that have taught us. So I also thought of the same thing. What should I do in this? If now, supposedly, I have this limited period of time, what should I do? What can I do? So I said, first, I have to make myself happy, not be depressed about having her. The second thing was not ensure that I make my two children independent so that tomorrow, whether I'm there or not there, they are not inconvenienced. And believe me, I sailed through the treatment. I went into the surgery. In fact, my husband operated on me. Surgery. I went through chemo cycles, 8 chemo cycles. I lost all my hair. But I was so happy during that time because I was at home for 24 hours. And I was with my children. I was there to receive them when they came back from school. I was there to play with them. You know, when I look back at that time, I'm actually thankful to God that he gave me that time, that I could spend so much time with my children, with my in-laws, with my parents, because 2 years later, my mother died. So that 1 year when I was going through that treatment and I was at home, I was in bliss. I never even once shed a tear that, you know, mujhe ye ho gaya hai. And I was so happy because I was not working. I didn't have the pressure of working. I was not asked to do any other thing. My husband suddenly became very proactive in the housework. Otherwise, my husband was one of those kind, you know, if you ask him, where do you get vegetables? Where are vegetables kept? He would say, vegetables come from the refrigerator. Because that's all he knew. He did not know anything else. But my husband changed. I was treated so royally in that one. So happy. So please remember, I mean, this is not a sermon, but this is something which I genuinely feel that God gives you problems not to trouble you, but to make you stronger and to give you more happiness than the actual trouble itself. So I was thrilled and I sailed through my treatment and, you know, now, and it's not as if I hid it from my children. My children knew that mama is having this problem and she's like, and they were also fine with it. And that 1 year, even my second standard daughter, she learned how to pack her bag. She learned how to, you know, go to school on her own, do everything on her own. And today now I feel a little sad because they don't need me. They are able to deal with their problems so well. So I'm actually thankful for that 1 year, you know, which happened in my life. And so now I have a set of students who look up to me. They are very, very proud of being my students. I'm very proud of being their tutor, their mentor. And in my unit, there used to be this thing, you know, this, okay. Namita madam ke unit mein koi bhi jayega na, uski shaadi achhe se ho jayegi. Because they would not get married and they would come here and I would ensure that, you know, they should be happy. They should have a good relationship and they, ladki bhagana hai bhagalo, but get married, have a happy life. So if you are happy, everyone around you is happy. And by happiness, I don't mean a smiling face. I don't mean laughter. I don't mean comedy shows. Happy is when you genuinely believe that I'm a great person. You know, I would, if I had to meet Osama bin Laden, I would tell him also that you're a great person. Only thing, your sense of thoughts, your thoughts have got a little misdirected. So my point here is that just be happy with yourself. You are beautiful if you're happy with yourself. Otherwise, pardon my saying this, but even Priyanka Chopra was not happy with herself. So she underwent so many surgeries. You please understand this. If you're happy with yourself, you will never find anything bad in yourself. So please be happy with yourself. You look beautiful. You are beautiful. You think beautiful. And that is, it's not necessary to have lofty dreams. It's not happy. It's not necessary to win the world. In your small world, if you are, let me, how do I put it? If you're a, you know, a rakhi maker, a person who makes rakhis and sells beautiful rakhis. If you're that person, be happy with that. And your rakhis will be so beautiful that, you know, your happiness will reflect in your work and people will recognize that work and they will acknowledge you. Don't start the work for acknowledgement. Acknowledgement will come. It doesn't matter. Nobody told me I was a good surgeon when I was learning. Now I get people who tell me yes. And it's never about the surgery. In everybody, I teach my students. It's never about the surgery. What surgery is a carpenter's job. You are dealing with human beings. You have to interact with the human psyche first. You make the person understand that he is not well, but he's not sick. He's just not well. He will become well. So please learn to love yourself and then live life with lots of fun and lots of happiness. I think that's it. That's about it. Thank you so much for patiently listening to me. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Namita. You indeed are a star because you faced all the challenges, the sexist remarks of your colleagues when you were training, the balance that you tried to maintain between work and your home, the guilt that you had to deal with, that you're not doing enough for your family, and finally cancer. And you have survived all that so marvelously. So kudos to you, ma'am. And I would now request Dr. Shreema Banerjee to post the questions that have been posted by the participants for Madam on the Zoom chat.
Yes. Thank you, Manjit ma'am. First of all, Namita ma'am, hats off to you. Heartfelt salutations. Really, the chat box, ma'am, full of appreciation. And you have touched each one of us by sharing your stories with such a great modesty, ma'am. Really, hats off to you from the bottom of my heart, ma'am. Really, salutations to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. But all of us are doing a very good job. Everybody who is struggling is doing a great job. And I salute all of us.
Yes, ma'am. Very truly said, ma'am. But kehte hai na, ma'am, ki duniya mein kitna gham hai, mera gham kitna kam hai. You have really touched upon that, ma'am. Ki sab log, each and every person is feeling, and the small increases that you have shared, really, ma'am. Really a heartfelt salutations to you. Ma'am, there are a few questions, ma'am. Like, Amrita Dayal, ma'am, has asked, the trial and tribulations of a man and women are the same. Was it disheartening when people said that you did good job being a woman surgeon? Though it is an appreciation, but a gender bias to the core. So some light if you would like to throw, ma'am.
I totally agree. Like the previous speaker said, it's a pilot. It's not a female pilot or a male pilot. I would never feel happy when they would tell me, oh, you're a woman surgeon. No, I'm a surgeon. And you have to, we have to more prove it by our actions and by our decisions, because the male counterpart is always ready to challenge your decisions. Like how, you know, it is assumed ki ladies ko driving aati nahi hai. It is same, it is assumed that ladies ko surgery aati nahi hai. And one or two incidences when the surgeon, male surgeon is in trouble and we go to help them, that is the time when their mindset changes, but their attitude still does not change because they still have the ego. So it happens. It is disheartening. It is discouraging also at times, but that is where our personal conviction comes into play. I'm good. So aaj nahi to kal, they have to accept it. We just have to wait patiently and not, how does one say it? No reactions, but response should be an improvement in our abilities rather than trying to show them down.
Thank you, ma'am. There is another question. Women are women's biggest barriers. We'd like to have your thoughts.
I agree with that. But having said that, the crab mentality is same for men also and for women also. even men pull the other men down, and so does women. But yes, I agree with you, because that we have to face. I would understand that, you know, a working mother-in-law would be more sympathetic towards a working daughter-in-law, but it doesn't happen like that. In many scenarios, the working mother-in-law always feels that we've had more struggles than you, and you are not doing enough. So yes, we have to deal with that. So we, in that manner, we are dealing with two enemies at the same time.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is, what are the early symptoms of breast cancer, if you can kindly guide?
Yeah, so see, the most important thing about cancer, I would like to inform you all, is that largely many cancers remain asymptomatic. Means they don't have symptoms till they are spread enough to create havoc. So we have to be vigilant about small pointers which tell you. One thing about breast cancer that you all must follow and must practice is self breast examination. Every day when you're taking bath, always attempt to feel your breast, both the breasts. And if you feel any lump or any irregularity, please visit a doctor at the earliest. And this is more so for that category of people who have had a family history of breast cancers. For example, if your mother or mother's sister, or on your mother's side, if anybody has breast cancer, you are prone to, you will come in the high risk category. So unmarried women who have not breastfed, women who have taken oral contraceptives for a very long time, women who have taken hormonal replacement therapy. This is a category of people who should be more vigilant about their breasts than the normal population. The normal population, the rest of the population, it is very important to do breast self-examination. If you can hold another session, I can teach you all how to do that, but not right now, but that is very important. You will get a lot of YouTube videos also showing how to do self-breast examination. So that is one thing that you can do. Secondly, any lump which is palpable in the breast, please visit the doctor immediately at any age group, because malignant lumps are painless. They do not give pain. And it is the mentality of our Indian women ki agar pain nahi hota hai, toh they ignore it. And that is the nemesis. That is when the cancer starts, you know, growing rapidly. Any lump, if you feel any discharge from the nipple, bloody discharge, greenish color discharge, you must visit the doctor immediately, preferably a surgeon. Okay. So this is the risk thing. Other little advanced symptoms are loss of weight, loss of appetite. So for breast cancer specifically, if you ask me, if you have these high risk factors, which I just enumerated, you be more vigilant, self-breast examination. And for women above the age of 40, doing a mammography once in a year is helpful to detect early detection of, you know, very small tumors, which can be treated very conservatively.
Thank you, ma'am. Yeah. There is another question. How would you meet family's expectations? As you have mentioned, you have made several arrangements, but still there were a few expectations which needed extra help. So how would you manage such a situation?
Okay, so to answer this, let me begin with this situation. This is life. It's not mathematics. So you cannot score 100 out of 100. You cannot please everyone. You have to let go of certain things, and you have to face that brunt and the accusation. Ye tumhari wajah se hua. Tum agar hoti, to ye nahi hota. That blame you have to accept. You have to live with that blame. You cannot perform well 100%. So maybe at my, you know, family side, I may have scored 60%, but that is the best that I could do. Certain things you have to accept that you were not able to do. Rest of the things, is your choice how much gradation of commitment you want to give at that point of time. Many a times the circumstances are such that they limit us. Many a times it is our own choice to not do it or to do it. Like there were many festivals that I would not be able to be. Many Holis and many Diwalis, I was not at home because I was operating. But these are the things that you have to live with. We are not gods, we are human beings. So certain amount of blame, certain amount of accusations, we have to live with it and we have to accept it. Having said that, that is not the reason why I should hate myself and why I should consider myself as a failure.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for answering all the questions that was put up on the chat box. Few more questions which can be put up on the WhatsApp group. It will be definitely addressed to. Over to you, Manjit, ma'am.
Thank you, Shreeva. And Dr. Archana, are there questions on the WhatsApp chat?
Yes, Manjit ma'am. Definitely.
We can take one. We can take one or two because we have overshot our.
Yeah, the one which has been posed is totally a different question, not answered. Yes, yes. So we can just ask. Yeah, good afternoon, Namita ma'am. And it was a very inspirational talk for all of us, ma'am. Thank you so much. Ma'am, the question which we have on the WhatsApp group is, with the experience you have, do you feel the men fear our multitasking capabilities or is it the men ego?
It is more of the ego. It is difficult for them to... they fashionably like to project that they are very accepting and they are very applauding of our capabilities, but there is a definite insecurity in their mind. How can, this has been my experience in my, they are intimidated by a capable person. And it is more of their ego that they know it, that she's better or she's as good as me, but their attitude still remains, I'm the boss. So the point here is that once you know this fact, the point here is that we don't have to interact with their ego. You have to keep doing what you want to do and don't waste your time trying to, you know, bother yourself. Ye kyun nahi samajhta hai? Why doesn't he understand? Why doesn't he behave properly? It will not happen. Leave it at that. You continue your work. At some point of time, there will be some meltdown. So it is definitely the ego.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, one last question. Every woman, whether working or homemaker, has life like a walk on the tightrope. Many a times, even though we maintain calm on the outside, the turmoil within takes a toll on the health.
Definitely.
The question is, does compromising, ignoring, or trying to stay calm help in any way?
Yes. Let us take each word, compromising, ignoring, and calm.
Yes, ma'am.
So, one thing you understand that you should work with the purpose. Your performance has to be the purpose. What is the purpose? Is the purpose to raise my child properly, or is the purpose that my in-laws are happy with my presence at home, my handling of children? You're not here to please anybody. You are not here to meet anybody's expectations. You are here to do what you feel should be done at that particular. I feel that I should spend these 4 hours for my child. So I take a decision of not going for private practice to go to a government institution where I'm available from 9 to 4, and after 4, I'm at home. This is my choice. This is my purpose. My purpose is to spend time with my child. My purpose is not to show my in-laws and my husband that I'm trying to spend time with my child. So your purpose has to be very clear. don't try to please anybody. The tight rope is tightened by us only. Oh, my mother-in-law has to keep appreciating me. My father-in-law should not find fault in me. My husband should not find fault. No, they are all going to find faults in me. Please define the purpose. The purpose is that I should be of assistance to my husband, not because I want him to be happy. It's because that is my decision. So the tight rope is tightened by ourselves. So don't tighten the rope. In fact, loosen the rope. Bring down the expectations from yourself. We fight with ourselves. I must reach up all places on all times. No, it doesn't happen like that. You can't attend all PTMs. You can't attend all functions. You can't do it. Just accept that. Loosen the rope. Calm yourself and define purpose, every small thing. What is the purpose? I want to see a smile on my child's face. What does he want? Within a reasonable frame of wants and demands, fulfill it. That does not mean that you pamper your child. So please analyze this. It's very important for us to remain calm, because what the person was asked this question is rightly said, that it takes a toll on our health. When you try to meet everybody's expectations, you compromise your soul and your energies. Don't do that. You don't have to score 100 marks in all the tests. It's all right to score less. The point here is to do what you think is the best for the person and for yourself. Anything involves happiness. If cutting your hand gives happiness to your family, it is foolishness to cut your hand, because you're damaging yourself. So in that manner, let me tell you the Eklavya story. I disagree at that point of time. It's not right. You have denied the world of a great archer by of action. If cutting your hand is going to help your family, it's not, you're damaging yourself. Don't do it. So please define the purpose of your action and follow the action. Don't try to please everybody. If you are a people pleaser, you will definitely land into problems.
Very rightly said, ma'am. And thank you so much. Over to you, Manjeet ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Namita. And thank you, Dr. Archana. I now request Dr. Pallavi Talekar to propose the vote of thanks to our speaker, Dr. Namita.
Good afternoon, everyone. In the beginning, I would like to thank you, Namita Madam, for sharing your inspirational story with all of us. You have shared reality of the life, professional front that each one of us is facing with respect to gender discrimination. If we think about girls today, they always face now conflict when it comes to taking decision in family and in profession. But your journey has taught us that how to take decisions in life. You have taught us many values, many principles today, ma'am, and we are really grateful to you. You've learned that career is not a matter of option for the girls. Everyone needs to have a purpose in the life. Respecting yourself, investing time in people, and having faith in yourself is very important. And we have really cherishing these memories, these principles of yours, and would like to follow the same, ma'am. At the same time, you're focused on balancing between family and the profession, which is very important for getting satisfaction in the life. Ma'am, the mantra that we have got from you today is, we have learned from you today is, be positive. Your actions will speak to you. Ma'am, you have reiterated many times that irade pakke ho to kuch bhi mushkil nahi. And to all the girls which are here, I want you to keep this in your mind now. Nothing is impossible in the life. Ma'am, your thoughts have enlightened our mind and shown us a new path to take decision and live life. On behalf of our management, Gujarat Research Society, our principal madam, Dr. Anita Swami, staff, students, and all the participants, I extend a heartfelt thanks, madam, to you. We are fortunate enough that you have spent your precious time from your busy schedule with us today, and you have shared your experiences in life, which of course helped all of us to rethink about life, rethink about ourselves as women, madam. So thanks a million, ma'am, for being here with us. Thank you very much.
I really thank all of you all for patiently listening to me. Thank you so much for inviting me. I'm really very honored. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Namita, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Namita. Thank you, Dr. Pallavi Talekar. Indeed, we hope that we have been able to ignite the spark in all our participants today. And on the eve of International Women's Day, as you leave today's meeting, go with some resolve in your heart that you are going and you're going to go out and achieve your dreams. So over to you, Dr. Vaishali Savant. I would request you now to give your concluding remarks and the overall vote of thanks for this.
Thank you, Manjeet Madam. Thank you, Manjeet Madam. And a very wonderful afternoon to each one of you. Wonderful because it is a wonderful afternoon. So inspired we are. Our stars have conveyed to us every challenge and hurdle that you cross takes you a step closer to your dream. So it is important to not give up and push forward when it feels impossible. Hold on to your dreams and not give up. Anjali Gopalan, madam, shared with us her experience as to how a cause grips you and you spend your entire life for it. You don't value yourself, you don't protect yourself, was the message given by Anjali, madam. She shared her experiences about how it is important to develop confidence in women, develop their inner strength, be open, have different ways of thinking. It is important to develop skills. He also gave us a message that rights is a part of continuum. He also said that we need to go beyond and ensure that we make the world a better place to live. Then Captain Jaswinder Kaur, pilot, gave her insights with respect to hurdles and challenges that can come your way, trying to achieve your dreams and how, with your presence of mind, being fearless, you can move ahead. Be the captain of your ship. Remember, there is a silver lining to a dark cloud, was the message given by Captain Jaswinder. Dr. Namita Chaudhary was so frank and open about her own life. We rarely get to listen to such talks. Dr. Namita Chaudhary, through her story, shared with us how important it is to hold on to your dream in face of all challenges of being a woman. Your performance should be guided by a purpose. Change people's gender-related beliefs through your actions, was the message given by Dr. Namita. I would say, what wonderful inspirational talks we had today. Thank you to all the three resource persons, the three stars. You truly inspired us. I express my heartfelt gratitude to our principal, Dr. Anita Swami Madam, for the guidance for conceiving this program and the support for conducting this webinar. A big thank you for the entire HSE team, which always lives up to the adage, alone we can do so little. Together, we can do so much. A huge thank you to the wonderful and interactive participants. They gave us so many questions beforehand. And, it was a wonderful time, your questions and the answers that we got from the resource persons. And, of course, our participants included our wonderful students also. Now, before we wind up and say goodbye, a very gentle reminder, fill up the feedback form, which would be put up on the WhatsApp group. The link would remain active till 8 p.m. Filling up of the feedback form is essential for procuring your e-certificate. And finally, I would say a very happy Women's Day to all the lovely women attending this webinar. And with this, I say goodbye and have a wonderful day. And I request Dr. Pallavi Talekar to end the meeting.